Hey, yo, what's good, what's good, what's good? Welcome to Reflections of a DJ, The Road Podcast, presented by DJ City. We got me, one of your hosts, DJ Crooked. We got DJ Neva.
Yeah, what's up?
We got DJ D Miles.
What's good, what's good?
We got Jamie the Great.
Yeah.
And, yo, we got a special guest, man. I've known this dude for a few years now. Got to know him through the clubs out here in Vegas. And surprisingly, I did not know how nasty he was until I saw him in person. And then I found out this legacy, this how much of a legend he was.
Yeah,
and well, he's part of this legendary crew, the Beat Junkies. We got.
We don't know about this in New York.
We don't know. We didn't know about.
We didn't know about it in New York. That's why.
But I learned about it out here, and I got schooled out here, and I got. Everyone was telling me this is the GOAT. We got the GOAT here. Shit, DJ Melo-D in the building.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. What's up, fellas?
What's up, man?
What's up?
Yeah.
Good to have you here, man.
Yeah, no, it's good to be here, man. Yeah. I love coming to Vegas.
When I was coming into Vegas, like, you were like, I came in like 2005, 2006.
Yeah.
You were coming in like probably 2007-ish.
You came in right behind you, actually. Like, yeah, I came in
pause,
February.
Yeah.
Ayo. I came in shortly after you did.
Yeah. Perfect.
I came in, February of 06.
06.
Yeah. So, long-winded story, but long story short, I did like a few auditions at Body English, mm-hmm. ended up blocking that Saturday night.
Yeah, you were at Body English, and then you also at Jet.
Yeah, Jet.
And that's where I met you at, Jet.
Yeah, and did a couple years at the Palms after that.
We actually had, like, you and I had one of the shortest residencies ever, which was at Eve.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's right. That shit lasted like 3 weeks.
It was Eva Longoria's nightclub restaurant.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
I think it lasted a month and a half.
Maybe.
Or 2 months.
That long?
Maybe. Yeah. But when it opened, I mean, it was.
That's right. I forgot about that.
It was kind of. It was already a rough start, though, right?
Yeah. Just the whole way they
I
had
it set
up. I've
never even seen
right?
the spot.
Oh, okay. Yeah. It was cool. It wasn't, you know, wasn't really. You walked in. For me, it didn't really feel like a nightclub. You know what I'm saying?
How many nights did you end up doing? I did.
Yo, I ended up being there like 3 nights a week, I think.
Really?
I think it was, yeah, like Thursday or Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Like it started as one because one of the former managing partners of Body English, Corey McCormack, he was involved.
Yeah, I know Corey.
And so he pulled me in. And then introduced me to I forget the guys' names that ran the dancing production or whatever.
I don't know.
But I don't know whatever was happening behind the scenes. But apparently, like, after the first couple times I played, they were, like, asking for me to, can I be there more? So
yeah,
I was like, yeah, okay, cool, like, whatever. Not just playing around y'all, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, so, but yeah, I forgot about that. Damn,
I think
that was crazy.
I only did, like, 2 dates, and I think I bumped into you. I forgot if you were spinning or if I was spinning.
She.
And then I think we were talking, and Mike Carbonell was DJing there, too, right?
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, shout out to Mike. And then I think shortly after, I was like.
It was a wrap.
I think the 2 nights that I was there, it was, like, pretty, it was, like, it wasn't packed. It was like semi full.
Right.
And then I think I saw you and it was like semi full.
Yeah.
And then I was talking to Mike. I'm like, how do you think this is going to go? He's like, I don't know, man. And I was just like, all right. And then like a few weeks later, they were like, yo, it's a wrap.
It's a wrap. Yeah.
Grand opening, grand closing.
Grand opening, grand closing.
I feel like there were a lot of clubs doing that at that time.
Yeah.
Because it was around.
That's like 2013.
Remember the act? Something? The act?
That was another spot. Yeah. I DJed there once too. That was at Venetian, right?
Yeah.
I never forget. I was
the
Friday
too,
I was supposed to DJ there.
Uh huh.
They decided they were gonna close that weekend.
Damn.
So I never got to DJ at that spot.
The act
grand closing.
Yeah.
They had like a weird concept though.
Yeah.
Like they were like you would DJ and then in the middle they would stop you DJing to do like a little burlesque thing on stage.
Yeah.
Like a midget.
It wasn't. It wasn't burlesque. It was like crazy.
Like almost like like a
oh that was a circus joint
yeah
okay
yeah.
I remember that
no but it's still in New York
yeah
right
yeah
it's big in New York right
it's yeah. really big in New York it's mm-hmm. still going strong in New York
yeah.
it's
yeah.
still like really doing it's really thriving in New York they yeah. brought it to Vegas but I think the location number one was really weird
yeah
it was kind of in the pocket right
it's
kind
yeah of it was hard somewhere. To find and
yeah
but it was always busy though like the times I went there it was never slow.
It was, but I don't know, man. I think that, yeah, but they used to do, like, weird shit. Like, there would be a guy up, like, a cowboy up there.
Yeah.
And then he would, what do you call those shits that clean the toilets?
I don't know.
Plunger?
No, the brushes.
Oh, right. Oh. Toilet brush.
Toilet brush. He would stick that shit up his ass.
Stop doing that motion.
Yeah, there was some weird, they were on some
Jamie, look
stuff,
at what man. I'm doing. You see
stop
what I'm
doing
doing?
That.
He would do this.
Peter, yeah. Zoom into the motion that he's doing.
Yeah, the night I was there was some dude that came out for whatever show they were doing and the dude was wearing a fucking Baphomet mask. I was like, yo, what is this? Like, it's just like, oh, yeah, it was weird, man. It was pretty odd.
It was fun, though. I mean, so like,
it was cracking.
You like, would DJ for like 20 minutes.
Right, right.
And then a show would come out.
Yeah.
And then you would DJ for another 20 minutes, and then a show.
Yeah, yeah. Did y'all have to wear the radio? They had me wearing the radio piece that night. They wanted to communicate. Because remember, there wasn't the DJ booth like up top in the balcony.
Yeah,
man, now so I'm trying to DJ wear headphones, and I'm wearing like this radio mic so I can listen to the production. Like they're trying to kill me. I'm like, man, fuck, I'm not doing this bullshit.
And it didn't really have a dance floor either, right?
Like, no, just, yeah, that's right. It was kind of like standing room only in front of the stage. Yeah,
I think it would have done better if it was in a better location.
Yeah,
yeah. Because it was interesting. Like, I wouldn't have mind going there on my off night, like, during the week, just to check it out.
Yeah.
Yeah, the concept was cool. It just didn't fly, right? That was open for, what, like, maybe a year?
Yeah.
A year or so? Yeah. No, but the party itself, I remember that. Yeah, I was jumping.
That was, like, a weird time, though. It was, like, when a lot of clubs were, like, opening, and then they were just closing, like, after a year or some shit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the fuck it was. It was like they
even like that. What Bagatelle was here for like a hot
Bagatelle. About that one,
Damn, man.
Bagatelle.
Yeah.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah. Calling out all these short-lived clubs right now.
Bagatelle, and then it turned into something else after Bagatelle, and it lasted for a few months.
Yeah.
I mean, I went there once. Five was DJing. There was like a brunch or something they used to do.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That was their big thing. Yeah, yeah, brunch.
And that's the thing too, because that still goes on in New York. The Bagatelle brunch is popping.
Is it still in New York?
What I heard is still popping. But, and then even in L.A., I think the one in L.A. closed, but the one in L.A. was popping for a
bit. That one in Miami also.
Sunday brunch. Yeah.
Mm, okay.
What do you call it? Now that we got you here, we've been doing research on it. And, Jamie, D-Miles, and P-Dot, they're from Cali, so they know, they got the history about you guys. So me and Neva... You know,
we're from the East Coast.
We're from the East Coast, I was aware of J-Rock mixtapes. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But you know, with you coming out, I remember everyone's like, "Yo, Melo-D," and I'd be like, the "Fuck is Melo-D?"
Yeah, man.
And they'd be like, "You don't know the Beat Junkies?" I'm like, "I don't know what the fuck. I know the Beat Nuts. I don't know the Beat Junkies."
Fucking cycle.
Yeah. But then, what do you call it? You guys, I mean, so you guys started in '92, right? You guys kind of formed like Voltron in 92.
Yeah, so J-Rock, he's we call him the Funky President. He's actually the one that kind of like clicked us all together and actually like came up with the idea of forming a DJ crew.
Right.
Uh-huh. But in the maybe year or two prior to that, we're all basically based out of Southern California for the most part. A few of us came from the area I grew up in, which is Cerritos, which is a small suburb. It's right smack dab in the middle of LA and Orange County. So I'm like 10 miles north to downtown LA, and the beach is 10 miles south of me. That's where I was born and raised.
What was the likelihood of all of you guys being so nasty and being friends and then just having to start this click? Or like, how did this fucking happen?
So I don't know, like in New York, because I didn't make it out to New York until my younger adult years, but in Southern California, like mobile DJing was huge. Like I'll say in California in general, like up in the Bay, down in LA, so we would have like mobile crews. So you know, cats would go out and do like
a system.
Like, you know, bass cabinets, like the whole shit, you know what I'm saying? And like cats would go out and do like house parties, high school dances, quinceañeras, all that stuff. But you know, these are primarily young guys, like, you know, teenagers doing this, like, you know, 15 to 20 year old young kids. And so this is in the 80s, so we're playing like, you know, Latin freestyle, Miami bass music, you know, a lot of West Coast hip hop, whatever was coming out of the East Coast at the time, Queen Latifah, stuff like that.
Party
music, you know what I'm saying? And in that scene, a lot of the DJs, we had K-Day, 1580 K-Day. So the K-Day Mixmasters were kind of like, that was like Tony G, Julio G, that's like our Grandmaster Flash, our Cool Herc. They pioneered the whole mix show shit.
That was like the West Coast first radio station that played hip hop 24 hours.
Correct.
Right?
Yeah. I mean, they played some R&B too.
I mean, R&B, but definitely hip hop as
were,
well.
Yeah, and they were the first ones to ever basically do live mixing on the air. And they would get busy. You know what I mean? That's always kind of been the West Coast style. So they kind of fathered like that whole style. And
yeah,
that trickled down.
Julio G put you on, right?
Yeah, on the radio. But that they fathered kind of that whole style, like technically the DJ style. Mm-hmm. And that trickled down to all these mobile sound systems. Like everybody would like want to just be dope. Everyone wanted to be able to mimic what they heard on the radio. And you know, at the same time, we're studying you know, Jazzy Jeff, DJ Cash Money, DJ Scratch, EPMD, like all the greats. On the West, we had Joe Cooley, DJ Aladdin, Toddy T, Mixmaster Spade. So, and again, on, you know, West Coast DJs, they were just about fucking shit up.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So that's kind of what like inspired all of us. And so again, to answer your question, so myself, Rhett-matic, DJ Curse, we all came from Cerritos. J-Rock's like 10 miles south down in Orange County, closer to the beach. We connected with Short and Shortcut and D-Styles years later. They're from the Bay. But that was kind of our common thread. Like, we all just, you know, we're kind of known for getting busy. I kind of came up under those guys' wings because Curse and Rhett, they already had these huge mobile systems, and they were doing like these hall parties with like 1,000+ like 18 and over events, and then we got like 1,000 kids, and they had this club called Spice on Hollywood Boulevard that ran for like maybe a couple years, from like 91 to like 93, and that shit was fucking out of here, fucking cracking every week. They had like two rooms. The main room was like the party room. They were playing like, you know, classic hip hop, mm-hmm. funk, 80s R&B, like fly shit, you know. Mm-hmm. And then they had this side room where it was like Curse, Rhett-matic. They had set up four turntables, and that was the room I went in every week. I kind of just walked straight through the main room. Right, I wasn't the party dude fucking trying to holler at girls. I was just like, I was DJ nerd trying to learn how to fucking DJ, and so I wanted to go study these guys.
In Rhett-matic's room, they were doing like backpack hip-hop and like, yeah, exactly, underground shit.
So this is like, you know, like early 90s hip-hop, Black Sheep, Digable Planets, all the classics, you know what I'm saying, like stuff like that, and you know, West Coast stuff too, but yeah, they have four turntables, and so, you know, that was kind of like my first time ever seeing cats actually 2x4, I guess is what you guys call it now, right? Yeah, 2x4. But motherfuckers was getting busy, you know what I mean? Yeah. And so I would just go in there every week and just kind of be the fly on the wall. And I didn't really know them at the time. And finally, one night, Curse, who's a member of the Beat Junkies, he approached mm-hmm. me kind of as the night was starting. And he steps to me and is like, yo, man, you're in the house every week. Like, bring some records through next time. I was like, psh. Hell yeah, like, you know, so next week.
It was
week,
that
like,
easy.
Yeah, I mean, he, you know, like, he approached me.
That shit would
me,
never
so.
Happen now. Yeah. I know, right? You would never see a dude that came here every week and be like,
bring your laptop.
Bring your laptop.
That shit wasn't happening in New York either, man.
Yeah. They were way, like, more, like, who the fuck are you?
Yeah, exactly. Why you keep coming, showing up, man?
Yeah.
It's Kitty.
Yeah, exactly. But anyhow, so that's how I formally kind of connected with those cats. And then from there, we just, you know, we kind of started practicing together.
Yeah.
You know, if Rhett-matic had a gig, he'd call me, be like, yo, Melo, I got this house party. You want to roll out? Like, yeah. So, you know, and I would tag along with them, and then vice versa if I had a gig.
What was the style when you were DJing back then? Because, you know, I always hear the radio style where it's like blending the instrumental and then scratching the...
Oh, when I was on the air?
Well, like I mean, at that party that you're talking about.
Okay, so... Yeah, that was pretty much the style.
It was formulated from the radio, right?
Yeah, we were, so the West Coast, you know, this is again late 80s, I'd say mid 80s to like up until 2000. Like the West Coast style of mix show or mixing has always been, we've been very avid about using doubles, two copies of every record, right? And utilizing our instrumentals to mm-hmm. transition to the next song. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, we would do doubles, you know what I'm saying? Like take two copies of the same record, it's time, and you know what I mean? Like get busy a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But that was kind of the style, like in terms of like mixing from song to song. Right. It was like, you know, having two copies of every record.
Yeah.
And you guys, I know y'all got records, so you guys can remember like, yo, 12 inches were dope, man. They had like, you know, some of the dance stuff would have like dub appellas.
Yeah.
Some of the hip hop would have acapellas. Mm-hmm. Yo, man, you could get real creative like back in the day. So
I always thought it was interesting because even in New York, we wouldn't blend in instrumentals. Very rarely would we do that.
Yeah.
At a party, we drop it on the one.
Yeah, yeah.
We drop it or mix it in.
Yeah.
Or just even just drop it and then just like, or just, you know, really just mix it in. But I find it interesting that whenever I talk to West Coast DJ, I said like, oh, I always learn from the radio.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it was basically mixing in the instrumental, probably scratching in the other joint and just juggling it around and whatever.
Right.
And fucking with it. And then did that kind of formulate to the way the Beat Junkies kind of the way you guys did routines and stuff? Because you guys do a lot of work with doubles, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's more like party rocking. That's kind of like something we would do like live, like if we're playing a gig. Because, you know, you don't want to disrupt the flow of the music.
Right.
Don't want to like, you know, start doing like strobe routines and like battle type shit. Right, you know what I'm saying? Like you want the party to keep rocking.
But I noticed like when I see a lot of your routines and stuff, which are nasty on Instagram.
Thank you, man.
Yeah. Ridiculous. And I remember like there was a couple James Brown routines that you would do like a Tao, and I'd be like, what the fuck? This is crazy.
That's probably why I never got called it.
And it was so like, and it's so like flawless and perfect. It's like the timing. I remember like I know this is a little off topic, but it reminds me of this, is that I would speak to like one of my dudes was in martial arts, and you compare like Jackie Chan and Jet Li, and I'd be like, what the fuck is the difference? And he's like, well, Jackie Chan is like, his form is not good, but he's entertaining. He says, but Jet Li's form is impeccable, and he's entertaining.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So like, I always thought of you as like that, like the Jet Li, when I would hear him, it'd be like, it'd be impeccable mixes. It wasn't like, word. It's because New York would be a little sloppy sometimes, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We'd be a little sloppy. We'd get the job done, but you know, whatever. Sloppiness was kind of a part of the, like the art of it all.
Formula. Yeah, no doubt.
But you're like, you're literally like, it was perfect. You sound pre-recorded like in a studio.
Yeah.
No.
Do you know what I mean?
I make mistakes all the time too. I'm offbeat every now and again.
But, I don't know if it's not about that.
But the whole West Coast style, that really just comes back to just kind of my environment. Like, you know, coming up as a DJ, like West Coast was always really big on, I mean, not just myself, but all the DJs. I feel like just, you know, a big part of our formula mixing was the 8-bar blend. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Yes. Like, if you guys ever heard me DJ in the clubs, like, you know, like, I would do that. I mean, it's more effective in the club that they would, you know, drop on the one, like, you know, more East Coast style. Mm-hmm. But like radio, live rocking, for sure, we are always, you know, very big on the 8-bar blend and like, coming in with that instrumental.
Which is why a lot of those, at the time, the Lethal Weapons, the
Mix Factors.
Yeah, the Mix Factors. Yeah. Those all came from the West Coast. Yeah.
Yeah, they did. You're
we
right.
never got You're those. Right. We never had
on the East Coast.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, damn, okay.
Like, so, I didn't even know those existed until I moved out to Vegas.
Matter of fact, I would pay like $30 to $40 just for one of those Mix Factors and Lethal Weapons, and I would spend like $250 to $300, $400.
Yeah.
Like,
there was another one called Rerun, right?
Or there was several. Yeah, there was a Rerun, Lethal Weapon. Yeah. Yeah, Mix Factor, Mix
It. I still got some labeled in my Serato as Lethal Weapon.
Yeah.
That probably
those were dope. Those were like really like handy tools back in the day for sure.
So when you guys were coming up and you guys were doing the sound system parties, you guys were going around and stuff, J-Rock was like, collectively we should just kind of like team up. Was
basically,
and I had a question. Did you guys team up on a business level to be like, look, we can form this crew and then we could do like multiple parties here and there? Or was it on some like DJ battle shit? Were there like other crews forming?
No, we were kind of the first. I think the Executioners, or formerly the X-Men, which is Rob Swift, Rock Raider, you know, RIP. It was really close. They might have been formulated around the same time, but to answer your question, you know, we were young, man. We were like early 20s, and so again, our common denominator being music. And you know, J-Rock was never, he would get busy, like he would scratch with us and stuff, but I don't know if you guys have ever seen him DJ or, you know, had a chance to talk to him or meet him or speak to him, but he's really more of a mix DJ.
Yeah,
like he's a fucking heavy record collector. His like collection is stupid. Like you can talk music,
his mixtapes are insane.
Insane, bro.
Soul samples.
He's
everything.
Always in the lab, like to this day. And so, you know, he was always, again, us doing these events together, these clubs, these you know, restaurant bars, house parties, etc., etc. Us DJing together. It was his concept was, yo, like we're practicing together, we're DJing together. You know, we're tagging along with each other to the gigs. Let's just form this super crew. Right. Let's call it the Beat Junkies. And so all that like was his idea. Mm-hmm. And that was in 92. But again, in the year or so prior to that, that's kind of like when we were kind of just building as homies. But to answer your question, no, we weren't really thinking like, yo, we're gonna form this, you know, we're gonna call it Beat Junkies LLC, yo.
LLC.
I'm gonna own 10%, you're gonna get, you know, none we weren't thinking on that level.
Well,
at all.
I was wondering, like, you know, like, you know, like obviously in New York there was gangs and stuff, and it was breakdancing gangs, and it turned into like hip hop and all of this crazy shit. And I was just wondering if in LA, if there was other battle DJs out there and they just started cruising, you're like, yo, we're the Beat Junkies and stuff like that. But you guys just celebrated your 25th year anniversary in 2017, right?
Yeah, we didn't really formally celebrate, but it was our 25th, 2017.
Well, you launched your school.
Yeah, that was kind of like our way of celebrating. It was like, it was the
25th, right? So you launched your school, and I feel like you guys, like you just said, like, oh, you know, we were just like in our 20s, we just started a crew, and then... I mean, you guys are kind of like a corporation now.
We have a few.
You know what I mean?
On paper,
on paper, I mean, you have a record pool. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not as good as DJ Cities, but you know, just because they sponsor us, you know what I'm saying? No, but you have a record pool, right? You guys have, I guess you guys are doing merch as well. Mm-hmm. And then you guys, like you said, you launched like a is it a YouTube channel or is it? Is it Beat?
We have a YouTube channel. Yeah, we've had it for years.
But and the just, Beat Junkies TV.
Beat Junkies TV. So that's a website. That's our online DJ school. And it's also a subscription model.
Got it. Yeah, okay. Right.
So that's for people that physically can't make it to our actual DJ school in LA.
Got it.
So, yeah. And
oh, so you have the physical school.
Right.
And then you have like an online crash course.
Correct. Crash course. So we basically, the online is we basically film pretty much twice a month. And we film pretty much all the lessons, all the curriculum, all the concepts, you know, from beginner to intermediate to advanced. We film all those in videos. So we have, I think, close to 150 videos now.
Is there like a membership to that?
Yeah. So there's basically same formula as our record pool. So oh, sorry, I'm a little loud. There's a 1 month, a 3 month, and a year, an annual. So, you know, I think the monthly is 35, the 3 month is 90, I think the annual is 360. Mm-hmm. I think the prices might mirror our record pool. I have to double check.
I tried to join the school when it first opened, like the first 2 weeks. Mm. And I was like, oh, I'll pay whatever money to get some scratch lessons for Melo-D.
Oh.
But that wasn't part of the curriculum yet.
private lessons.
Yeah, they were like, oh, no, you got to start from, like, you know, the beginner's course. And I was like, oh, I know half of this
Wait,
shit.
When did you go right. there?
This is like the second week it started, like 2017.
So you heard that the school.
Yeah, it's right by my house.
Okay.
It's like,
and they approved your application?
Yeah, they did. They're like, yo, you're good.
Did you fill it out in crayon? Or
yeah.
What'd you do?
Okay. Because there was a lot of kids there too. Right? They were all practicing.
They wanted to put you in the class with the little kids?
Yeah, yeah, the little kids.
I'm thinking Billy Madison, remember?
I got hold back.
Billy Madison.
That's funny. Yeah, the school itself, the curriculum, it took us essentially about a year to build out, to just, you know, just to all of us kind of put our heads together. What are we going to teach? How are we going to teach it? You know, and when we opened, probably around the time you came, we were still kind of figuring it out.
Yeah.
And it took us like a good, I'll say year, because we were kind of just, you know, we had ideas. Some of them stuck. Some of them didn't. Some of them had potential. But, you know, we just didn't know how to connect the dots properly. Yeah, but I feel like I'm confident when I say now, like 2019, finally 2 years in, we have a really, really good formula.
Well, that class that I wanted to join is now happening.
Which one is
the master class one?
Okay.
The one that sold out really fast.
Right. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. That one. That was the one I thought I was going to join.
Oh, okay. Okay. Mine master class?
Yeah.
That was recent. That was last winter.
So what I thought when the school opened, I thought that was part of it.
Oh,
but I think that barely just came out.
Yeah. That's a new one for us. So I've done one. D Styles has done, I think he's done two. Babu recently did one. He did a 421 in April. J-Rock's doing one this month. I think the 23rd.
Yeah,
June. Sunday the 23rd. Yeah. So that's something that we're going to continue to keep in the fold moving forward.
When you guys opened the school, right? Mm-hmm. What brought that on? What initiated that?
Well, Chalk had been teaching at Scratch Academy for a decade.
Wow. Yeah.
And he. Whose idea? It was actually D-Style's idea. We were just kind of sitting around like we all are now, and just, I think, over dinner or something, and D-Style's, approached us because we had the record pool, and that was going really well for us, and so we were looking to start something new. And so D-Styles is like, what do you guys think of opening up a DJ school?
Mm-hmm.
And just like, it kind of like clicked for all of us right away because, we got the dean right here sitting in front of us, Chalk. He's part of the crew, you know what I'm saying? Like, he can walk us through the curriculum.
Yeah.
And so so that was kind of what, you know, birthed the idea. And, 3 years ago, 2016. And, you know, we had all kind of like been looking to kind of scale back on live DJing and not necessarily have to rely on that, you know, as our sole source of income. And we thought we could do it in a very cool, unique way that other cats weren't doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, the concept of a DJ school, we were not the first on the block, but, you know, there was very few. That market was still completely wide open in our minds. And so, all right, we said, let's do it. And so we started kind of scripting everything. And we must have looked at, probably 20 different spaces before we settled on our location. Just scouting out like locations. We saw a really sick one that we kind of slept on in downtown, and the reason we kind of passed on it was because of the parking.
Right.
You just like great. You know what I mean?
I don't know if anybody knows, but it's on Glendale, and it's right next to the freeway, and there's like Astros is up there.
Yep,
it's right down the street. Mm-hmm. Which is where I used to buy a bunch of my needles before they discontinued.
I know.
So that was that. And then there's a Deja Vu strip club. But you awesome. Drop off your kids.
Very nice. Good.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah, it's right across the
but
street.
But no, the parking is
so
great.
All the parents can wait for their kids.
Yes, yeah, at Deja Vu down the street. Okay. Yeah. Or you go to the mall down the street. But no, the parking is great. There's a lot of parking in that big ass street. So
yeah, because we're kind of in this industrial area, and all the businesses, they kind of shut down like at 3. Like there's like a burger spot, like you walk in there, like knock on the door, like it's a wrap at 2:00 in the afternoon.
Yeah.
So everybody shuts down their business, they just go home, call it a day. Yeah, so that leaves the streets open for the parking.
Yeah, the
stuff,
roller
so.
Rink, and then the Home Depot's part.
Exactly. Yeah.
I'm really fascinated with operations and logistics, so I want to know exactly at what stages you guys started. You started the curriculum first, Did you look for a space?
We looked for a spot first.
You did?
Yeah. And we basically moved into, once we found our location, it was basically an empty warehouse. So we had to physically build it out. So, you know, we did some reconfiguring with the actual structure. We put up a couple walls.
So you guys did all the contract work pretty much?
Everything.
Wow.
Everything. Yeah. Everything you see in there is custom built, the furniture.
It's a really lot of nice. It looks nice. The interior, thanks, man. Light is cool.
Y'all got to come through, man, if you're ever in LA, yeah. Like for
I've
sure.
I've been there a few times. It's great. Okay. It was a big deal when it opened. Like, everyone was like, yo, you heard about the Beat Junkie school? I'm like, yeah. It was like, yo, you might have to join. I'm like, that's what made me walk in. But yeah, it was a big deal in LA when that happened in 2017.
So to answer your question, like we had to physically build all that stuff out. It was very expensive.
How long was
that? About a year.
A year to build
it
out.
Yeah.
And at that time, were you taking students in?
No, we weren't even like, we didn't start actually sitting down.
So you had the space for a year.
Yeah.
You were paying rent, obviously.
We're paying rent, yeah.
You're building it out, yep. And then you were working on the curriculum at the same time.
The curriculum kind of started maybe 6 months after we started doing some research and figuring out, okay, we, you know, talking to different contractors and different companies, like looking at different ideas for the actual workstations, the DJ stands, the tables,
right.
Talking to all the different companies. A lot of the gear was gifted to us.
Yeah, I was going to ask you that because, yeah. I mean, you guys are so legendary. I'm sure, like, all of these people, like Pioneer and everyone would have been like, yo,
just take this.
We're just going to send you this
shit. Everyone's very
right?
supportive. Yeah. All the big dogs, Pioneer, Rain. There's
it's
a company
good to be,
called
Mixars. It's good to be like a GOAT status. You can just ask for free equipment.
Like
right?
Right? Rain.
No, it's cool, man. Like I manage, I just feel like, you know, it's kind of their way of kind of giving back. You know what I mean?
Right.
Just for, you know, us using their gear all these years.
But they're also trying to brainwash these little kids to be like, I'm going to get the Pioneer joint.
Yeah, but the Pioneer joint is fly, though. I love the S9, man.
You didn't have to buy any equipment.
The students.
Just for the students, yeah.
No, we bought, I think, a few pairs of 1200s, but the majority of our operating expenses was the actual build out of the building. So, like, the flooring, all the furniture, the retail counter, the DJ stands, those weren't cheap because those were custom made. Mm. We have what's called a longtagon in the back, which is basically like a big jam table with, like, I think we have 16 turntables and different mixers and stuff.
So it goes around like a circle.
It's crazy. Like, when you see it, it looks like a boot camp, like a really organized boot camp for like DJs. It looks crazy, yeah.
And, you know, sign out front. Man, there's so many things. Cleaning up the bathroom, like even little stuff, man, like just getting like posters framed. We have we had a guy create like a really dope skin for us that lives on the wall behind our retail counter. So just all the things just added up, you know. It wasn't all at once, but again, this took about a year to completely build out. And then maybe about 6 months in, once we kind of had our ideas locked in, okay, let's do this here, let's do that there, let's make this wall look like this, let's tear down that wall and, you know, whatever. That's when we kind of started, all right, now we got to sit down and like, what the fuck are we going to teach? How are we going to teach this shit? I don't know if you guys have ever try to teach or explain DJing to someone, but yo, like when we sat down and started like trying to figure it out, just like it was, I mean, for all of us, I feel like, with the exception of Chalk, that was the first time I think we all, man, how do you explain mixing?
Right.
How do you teach somebody how to mix? How do you explain the most rudimentary scratch, a baby scratch, a release, how do you explain that to someone that's just super green?
But not only that, like build multiple curriculums, one for certain ages, right? Because a younger age group, you're going to have to introduce it to them in a different way, or do you have it all the same pretty much?
Well, with the kids, I mean, you know, it just really depends on, you know, I guess kind of where they're at. Like we have a good handful of students that, you know, they've seen DJing through the years, they're music enthusiasts, they've always been curious kind of about the craft.
What's the starting age?
So
is there a limit, like you don't take, you know?
Well, again, this was kind of trial and error. So we had a couple kids classes and, you know, we found out very quickly that, you know, kids around say probably 9, anything younger than 9, it was just difficult for a few reasons. I mean, you know, physically they're not developed yet. Their attention spans, they're shorter. Yeah. They can't actually reach the turntables. Yeah, yeah. Their coordination's not quite there. So they would pick up the needle, tone armor, and scratch the record. You know, and then with the parents too, you know, they obviously have families and some of them are involved in extracurriculars. So it's like they couldn't commit every week.
Right, right.
So we quickly learned that, okay, we need to like kind of like just be able to, if we're going to take kids, like age 10 and up, you know.
So now it's 10 and up. Is that what it is?
For the most part. I mean, I think our kids that have been with us since day one, they're probably pushing like 11 and 12 years old. And it's amazing, man. Like, I mean, they came in just like, again, just curious about the craft. and they never touch turntables, you know what I'm saying? And like, you guys see them now, like right now there's a few of them. So our day ones, like, they're at the point now where like they're each on one turntable and they're making routines. Yo,
wow,
this shit is fucking mind-blowing.
And it's then you insane, start them all, man, with vinyl, right?
Mm-hmm. So our foundation program, which it runs for about a year, it's spread out over 9 levels, and so basically the first 6 months is on vinyl, taught on vinyl, and then we introduce digital, DBS, Serato, which requires a laptop, obviously. Mm. But our reason for that, you know, was because we obviously come from records, we come from crates and digging, you know, that whole school. But, you know, mechanically, you know, our mantra is kind of like, you know, you take all these concepts, all these techniques that we're going to teach you, everything from, you know, muscle memory to form, you take that and you learn it on vinyl, you know, which is analog, is always going to be 100% honest with you. Mm-hmm. You take a record off, you don't play it for a month, you go to put that Barry White, you know, LP on, that label is going to hit in the same exact spot, right, on the one or whatever, you know what I'm saying? So get them used to like using visual markers, concepts like that.
Interesting.
And then once you have a good grasp on that, yo, you can take that and you can apply all that to a controller, you can apply it to CDJs, you can, you know, whatever.
That's great.
Whatever the choice. Yeah. So that's kind of our method.
So everything you're breaking down right now is literally it was a 2-year process really to break it down.
Yeah, again, we had we ironed out what we thought was going to work for us, and then again we quickly learned, not just with the kids but even with the adults and some of the younger adults, like, oh, maybe this isn't going to stick, you know what I'm saying? Like, so it's just constantly just kind of like reworking our
and you're still reworking system. It probably like perfecting it a little bit, right?
always it's always going to be a work in progress, but I feel like, again, I feel finally like, you know, 2 years in, we finally, okay, like it's feeling right, you know what I'm saying? Like what we're doing now is working, and it's you know, we do other things too that are like, you know, we have a cool space, we do like events, we have a really dope back parking lot that's gated, so you know, we'll send our events, and it's all based around DJ culture, and we have like open turntables nights, we have like several regulars that come through.
Is there like a graduation thing or
there,
like,
is
a, does everyone graduate?
So
some people get left back.
We've had a couple students that, we've had a couple really? Students. We treat it like a school.
I feel like I would get left back.
You will.
I'm really uncoordinated. And I would be breaking all the equipment. You know? I would be breaking all the mixes.
No, we treat it like a real school. So, again, our foundation program is spread out over 9 levels. And so my class, I teach a class with Retmatic on Friday nights, and they just finished level 3. Uh-huh. And so we have them do what's called a vinyl final. So I know you've been there. So
the
we have
vinyl final. It sounds dope.
So we have 12 workstations, which, you know,
you better trademark that.
For a lot of shit, we need to trademark.
TM by Melo-D.
So we have 12 workstations, so we're capped at 12 students, but we have our instructor's podium, which is kind of like, you know, on a slightly elevated stage. So basically, the vinyl final is the students have to take one 12-inch, you know, Jay-Z 12-inch. They have to play that. They have to mix. We have school records that we press. We have 2 volumes, and it has, you know, beats, scratch kits, tools, etc. Mm-hmm. They have to mix an instrumental, a drum break, into the Jay-Z record, right? They have to take off the Jay-Z record. They have to put a second copy of the school record on the open deck, and they have to scratch for 8 bars. The basic scratches that we taught them.
You know, what's the basic scratches are you here?
So thus far, they've learned the baby scratch, which is, you know, Grand Wizard Theater. We've taught them the release, which is like if you're using the ah, it's like you take your hand, you physically take your hand off the record, so the sound just plays. Ah, vit, no fader. Ah, vit. And then we show them that with the fader. So you just get the forward motion. Ah, ah, ah. Then the tear, which is always been like a West Coast thing, which is a 3-part scratch, which is the what the transforming.
Okay, I can't do that. Y'all
need to come. Y'all need to come to school.
We got sent to the beginner's class.
I would have passed that.
I'm telling you.
So transforming. We all know what that is. Like, clicking through the sound.
I can't do that. See, I wouldn't have passed.
Stab scratch. So just basic.
Cricket's great at the stab scratch.
Do you have a class for slow learners? You
know? We have. We teach beginner levels.
For real?
But yeah, we have DJs. We have like working DJs that come through and sign up because they just kind of want to refine and polish up.
I would love to come to
class. Yeah, man. Y'all come through, man. Anytime, man. Open door.
We're going to come through soon.
Do you find it easier, or for being a teacher, like to teach someone that's just a blank page versus like a DJ to break old habits or some bad habits that you may want to refine?
It's easier to kind of to work with somebody that's somewhat experienced because they're familiar with the equipment, how it works, you know, where to properly place your hand on a record, you know, a split listening, like, you know, the proper way to mix, which is one earphone here, the other ear exposed, so you can, you know what I'm saying, hear the room. So there's less kind of review and presentation versus working with somebody new. And everyone's different. I mean, some people, they get it right away. Some people, we've had a few that just, they just don't have rhythm. They can't find the one, you know what I'm saying? And some of them eventually, like they're slower to learn, but eventually they come around.
Right.
Some of them just, they just don't, you know what I mean? It's just music, just period, is just not for them. But again, it just really comes down to just everyone individually.
I have a question, Professor Melo-D. Raise my hand. So you teach these kids all these techniques. Do you also teach them the history of DJing? Like, yo, this is Grandmaster Flash.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
So you do all that?
Yeah, every time we introduce, like, kind of like a classic technique, we always, like, I always like to think of our school as it's part lecture, part exercise. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the lecture part comes, like, when we give the history lessons, you know what I mean? We talk about the baby scratch. We definitely give dap to Grand Wizard Theodore. We tell the story about him, like, you know, being in his bedroom and his mom, Theodore. And he's like, yeah, Mom. And that's how he discovered baby scratch. Like, oh, shit, what am I doing right now?
Yeah, he holds it in,
Right. So, like, stuff like that. And definitely, like, you know, transforming, chirping Jazzy Jeff, right? We talk about, like, the terror scratch. That's, like, a West Coast style, like Joe Cooley, DJ Aladdin. So we try and give them a little bit of history, you know. And that's part of coming.
You ain't teaching them no East Coast scratches? Like, what would be East Coast scratch? East Coast scratch would be like, ba, chica, 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 chica.
So we do all that in the drills, but like definitely like Cash Money, Jazzy Jeff. I mean, but I'm just talking about specifically about New York.
I feel like there's a Grandmaster Flash, like a certain scratch that he does.
Like well, his. Just a regular chica, 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 chica.
Flash no, no, no. It's like the pa, chica, 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 pa, chica, chica, like that. Right? You know what I'm talking about.
No,
right?
With Flash, so we talk about Flash in level 8 because level 8 is breaks and beats. So we talk about how, like, you know what I'm saying, back in the park jams, like Flash like started rocking, you know what I'm saying, like rocking breaks back to back, keeping the loop going for the MC or for the B-boys or whatever, like, you know what I'm saying. So we definitely give dap to all the pioneers.
Damn, I feel like I gotta take this course now.
Yeah, I really wanna take this course.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Regarding the equipment, what type of turntables do you have using?
So we have different, we have a variety. And that was intentional because we want the students to be able to try a Technique 1200. We want them to be able to, you know, experiment with a turntable that's been released in the last 5 years, Pioneer PLX. So we have those.
You don't make
we
them start Nixars. With belt drives?
Yeah, you don't start with belt drives? Cricket would love to start there.
Heavy ass slip mats.
With like the 5-pound rubber slip mats.
So we have a Vestex, some old Vestex gear. Again, just for the sake of having variety. So everyone can just like, you know, kind of get a different feel.
Is there a place where you can have like the cool mixers that like the Vextax?
We do. We have a display case. Right behind the Long Tagon.
That sounds awesome.
We have like
the Grandmaster Flash one too.
We have the Gemini 2200 in there. We have the Vestax, the very first Vestax. We have one of the DMC competition mixers, not the original one, but the one that came out like in the late 90s, which was like had the gold trim on it. It was black with the gold trim, if y'all remember that one.
The Techniques mixer.
Exactly. Yeah.
What's your favorite mix of all time?
Right now, I've been loving the S9. But I mean, for years, I was just on the Vestex, the 05 Pro, the 07 Pro. When I was on the radio, that was my mixer. And even like when we would do clubs and parties and stuff, like we would always, that was the mixer we would bring along.
You were a Vestex champion?
96, yeah.
96. Mm-hmm. We just had Blind, right?
He Boogie was Blind.
Oh, Boogie Blind?
Yeah, Boogie Blind.
Dude, he's the nastiest man.
He's nasty.
His episode just premiered today.
Oh, it's sick. So okay, I got to peep that. But, shout out to Blind, man.
What do you got? He was 2001, I think.
The homie right there.
Yeah.
What happened to I meant to ask this to Blind, but what happened to Vestax?
You know, I'm not quite sure like why the company folded, but I couldn't answer the question. I don't know. I just remember like they just... I think maybe sales slowed down. I think this is kind of around the time when CDJs kind of like popped onto the scene, into the market. So maybe that had something to do with it. And then years later, not too many years later, Serato came into the fold. Right, so maybe that had also a little effect on, you know, sales for Vestax. But I mean, Vestax ran game on the DJ community for years. Yeah. I mean, they had this shit on lock. Everyone was using Vestax.
I think everyone had a Vestax at one point. Yeah.
And it was a great mixer, man. I mean, you know, the first
faders,
one was,
man.
Yeah, like they were butter. They were butter, you know.
I never had a Vestax.
You never had a Vestax?
I had one.
I had two 05s and an 07.
Yeah, man.
And to me, the best was the Technique, the gold, with the gold trim.
You like that one?
I had
that one. That was dope. I never had that one. I always wanted it.
I felt rich when I bought that one.
That was like a quality fucking mixer. Yeah, and it felt like you. It just the fader was.
The fader was nice. I remember the fader. Yeah. I had a couple homies that had it. Yeah, for sure.
It was fucking nasty.
Now that the shirt 447 were discontinued, what needles do you guys use?
So we have luckily we have some back stock, so
okay.
So those have always been my go-to needles.
Selling us some?
Shh, man, that's like
it was an attention. You know what I mean? Like, no, Melo-D was good.
Chico,
like,
right? Chico.
Chico's the new one, but they're like arm and a leg still.
They're not an arm and a leg, man. What are you talking about?
They're $30 and the shipping.
That's how much it costs.
Okay, but the shipping from Japan over here is like $50, kid.
Yeah, but then you get like 12 of them.
Yeah, just buy a bunch. Yeah.
Come on,
that's supposed to be the one though, right? Like a J Rock was actually telling me about that. Yeah, that's supposed to be. Yeah. That's supposed to be the one that's like closest to the 447.
Are you noticing? Well, I have two questions. One,
yes, sir. Raise your hand. We guys have questions. Professor Melo-D's here. My God, so respect for the curriculum.
My first question is: have you noticed that kids where they gravitate to? So when you have them on vinyl, mm-hmm. and then you obviously go to like Serato or Scratch Live, and you start doing, you know, all of that stuff. Do they still kind of miss the feel or the analog, you know what I mean, actual vinyl? Or
they come just in practice. They come in and practice, and sometimes they're opening up their laptops, and sometimes they're bringing a bag of records.
Really?
Like, it's crazy. Yeah, we have there are adults, our day ones, that have been with us since we opened, so 2 years. And they, you know, they went through the whole program the whole year. They graduated, and they're out gigging now, and, like, there's a few, like, there's this girl, I think she's a nurse, and she's quiet as kept, man. She doesn't say. She's very shy, you know, and just really soft spoken and very demure, you know. And yo, she's fucking beast. Like, she just never touched turntables before, and now I mean I wouldn't say beast in terms of like being able to, like, you know, get busy like in terms of scratching, but like, yo, she can fucking rock a party. She can, like, you know, play a set. Like, she's got great, like, you know, instinct with like programming, song selection. So it's pretty amazing, man. Like, just to like see somebody like just start from the absolute very bottom and just like kind of work their way and just start to learn, man. Like, everything from like the very basic things, concepts, mixing, and then even being able to incorporate cuts. And just everyone kind of like developing their own personality. It's really cool, man.
And then when to teach kids and stuff like that, do you need like a license or anything?
No, we have, you know.
No, I'm just not. I'm not.
They question Melo-D why he's teaching DJ. I'll slap the cop myself.
I'm just asking because me, myself, if I was teaching a bunch of kids, I'd have to change the way I speak because I curse a lot.
Definitely.
For sure.
And And then I don't know if there's like a certain training to like not like, I guess,
like an etiquette.
Well, not an etiquette, but like you want to stay positive with kids. Like, you don't, like, you know,
you want to encourage them.
I want to encourage them. Yeah. You don't want to be like, yo, what the fuck you doing?
Yeah.
Were you just listening? We told you not to do that.
Let me tell you. It's crazy, man. Like a true story. So this is maybe like a year ago. And this is again, our kids that have been with us, our children since day one. So they're about a year into the program. And, you know, so we would take them back to the longtagon where they could jam with each other, and we give them each 8 bars, you know. And so my partner, Babu, he started having them play. Y'all ever play horse back in the day, like basketball?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So we kind of like applied that same formula to turntables, right?
So one does a scratch, the other one has to copy it.
Right. Okay. So that would, you know, and if they don't copy it like correctly, they get eliminated. Mm-hmm. So there was a few of them that took it really hard, like going into the restroom, like crying, like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't want to do this anymore. You know what I mean? Because that's like, it's detrimental, like as a child, like, you know what I mean? To like be put kind of like
on the spot, like
pressure.
That.
Yeah. So, but I mean, no, we definitely do everything to encourage them. You know,
what do you guys say when something like that happens, when they go in the bathroom?
We keep it. I mean, well, something like that, like it's just like, you know, like, hey, is everything okay? And we just, you know, you have to pull them aside and talk to them.
You gotta do that puppy voice, right?
No, you gotta talk to them like kids, man. They're kids. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, you don't want to scar them, shit. You don't want to discourage them. You don't want them to not come back. Like, you know what I mean? You want them, that they're obviously there because they love DJing. And
you
they
don't do that Godfather joint.
Oh, that time.
When he shook him, he's like, "You can be a man." You remember that? You can be a man. You don't do that to them.
Don't never let Cricket be a guest speaker or a teacher.
You don't do that. Godfather. No,
that's
joint?
An interesting approach, though. Yeah. Yeah, it could work, man. Tough love works sometimes, right?
Tell me about it. Working with Cricket. Jesus.
So I had another question. Do you guys use CDJs?
Turntables? Yeah, so we actually have some coming. They're coming in a couple weeks. But Pioneer is gonna hook us up. Yeah, Pioneer's just because blessing. We want people to be able to practice. And you know, you guys know, you stepped over to a gig, and you know what I'm saying, you're either you have to ask for turntables or CDJs are just there. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So yeah, we want to be able to offer that.
Controllers?
Well. Mm-hmm.
Controllers?
We have controllers.
How many are they sending you?
I think we're getting two sets, so we're getting four CDJs and two. What is it? The Nexus 900 joint.
It's good to be the GOAT. Yeah. It's good to be the GOAT, right? It's good to be one GOAT status.
I personally don't like CDJs. I've used them just like in the clubs out here, just to transition. Uh-huh. And I've tried to mess with them. It's not the same, man. Like it's just not. Like they don't respond the same. You know, my style of DJing, like you know, again, rocking doubles, mm-hmm, stuff like that. It just nah, man.
Have you used the phase yet?
I have not tried it. Yeah, we got those coming too, though. Yeah. Those are coming our way.
How do you feel about
status? Gold status.
I mean, I've based on what I've seen and what I've heard, like they looked fucking sick. You know what I mean? Like everyone kind of swears by them. Like everyone's like, "Yo, this is the new shit." So
did you have a new PDA? Didn't you have a new update on the phases? One of them blew up, right?
Yeah.
What blew up?
Get a mic.
Blew up. What?
Get on mic whenever.
Hey, definitely didn't hear about this.
There's an issue with like the battery expanding and exploding in some of them.
No way.
Yeah.
It expands because it overheats?
Yeah, so they use like a cheap battery. So like, you know, when your MacBook, the battery kind of expands or your cell phone. So they're out for less than like 6 months and some of them are already doing that.
Oh, wow.
Wait, so there's been more than one explosion?
Like, there's a whole like Facebook phase support group. Like everybody that has like issues.
Oh my phase God. Support
that's
group.
That's Damn. Crazy.
That and did they just raise the price?
Yes.
They just raised the price.
$100?
No, I think it's like $30-$40.
No, it's it went from $399 to $459.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, so I'm like bucks. Okay, 60 yeah. bucks more.
Have y'all tried it? Anybody tried it?
Nah, not yet.
We're waiting for Facebook.
I used it at Everyday People DJ MoMA.
That's right, yeah.
It was cool. You had no problems, right?
Yeah, it's just like little things where I'm like.
But you did a 45 minute set, right? You did a small set. It wasn't like a whole night.
It was good though. I mean, I feel like I could scratch more aggressive.
Yeah.
Just because.
Right, you have to worry about the needle jumping.
Yeah. Stuff. Like, you can really get aggressive and just, like, really spin back and just, you don't have to worry about the fucking
needle. I remember that about you. Remember I show up to, like, a crooked gig out here, man? It'd be, like, keys missing on the fucking keyboard. Like,
oh, no, we just got him a new computer. Rick Ross paid for the new computer.
I don't want, if I go to the Beat Junkies Academy or the school, I don't want to get, like, judged for all of this shit.
No, we just did a podcast, and we called Bad Habits was a topic, so we talked about all of our personal bad habits and stuff that we've seen, like, you know, just other DJs do and stuff. Yeah.
Over drinking, so. Was that one of the times?
No, but yeah, that's I feel like, man, no, I definitely had a few nights out here when I was living out here.
Can you bring us as a panel and we talk about the working DJ and talk about the drinking?
We talk about working DJ stuff.
Yeah, you should have like a PhD class where we teach it, you know. Yeah. We teach them the ins and outs of the industry.
What not to do.
Listen, don't drink too much on your first night.
Yeah.
You guys also have a radio show, right?
Dash Radio.
Dash Radio. Mm-hmm. Right? How long have you guys had that?
What are we, 2019?
Yeah.
I want to say it's, man, be 5 years, like this fall.
2014.
Yeah, 2014, I think, is when they launched. And they're out in Hollywood. Their studios are out there. We have Retmatic hosts a live show called Soundcheck, second and fourth Tuesdays of the month.
Babu like curates it, or who's a part of that?
We were all doing it kind of initially, and then that just kind of became Retmatic's baby, so he heads up that whole show. But again, that's kind of like the focus there is just like new hip-hop, like indie hip-hop, not top 40, mm-hmm. but just like new, like indie underground hip-hop, you know, everything from MCs, producers, he has guests and stuff like that. Red heads that up, and that's us every second and fourth Tuesdays. It's called Soundcheck.
The second and every second and fourth Tuesday
mm-hmm. of the month,
mm-hmm. 7 to 10, right?
7 to 10, yep.
So you have the radio show and you have a radio background,
mm-hmm.
Because like around the college, I was looking at around probably around when you were going to college,
mm-hmm.
You were on the beat like 92.3, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you were with Kabichi. Were you on the air with Kabichi?
Kabichi, he didn't actually. So when I got on the air in 95, Julio and Tony G brought me in. And Kubichi was working as, he was just an intern, so he was kind of like doing like street hits. Like he would take the van out, he would do call-ins and stuff. Yo, we're over here at the El Torito, you know what I'm saying? We got the giveaway t-shirts.
And Julio G put you on pretty much?
Yeah. So I met Julio, and again, Julio and Tony G are kind of like the West Coast pioneers, right. You know what I'm saying? Like they were the ones heading up K-Day doing all the live mixing.
We were talking to the Jamie D and P-Dot. We were like, trying to compare them, then I guess we were like seeing like a red alert.
I feel like the red alert on Mr. Magic.
They came in a little later. I mean, I'm sure they were DJing at the same time, but I feel like, you know, like the OGs, like out in your guys' area, like they were on the air before that, because that's like, well, that's like early 80s, right? Early to mid 80s.
Yeah. So I would say, so like, around the same, I would say Mr. Magic.
Yeah. No, exactly. So Julio and Tony would be Chuck Mr. Magic. Yep.
Did Julio G just hear you at a party or just heard about you, or were you just building a name?
So there was a record pool called Ghetto Baby Record Pool. And,
that's an amazing name.
Yeah, and it was actually, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the Baker Boys. They were on Power Line 6 for years. So their older brother, Frank V, headed up this record pool called Ghetto Baby. And I think there was like 20 DJs, you know, just again, we're all, you know, kids from Southern California, and that's how I met Julio and Tony, because they were on the radio at the time. They were on the beat, so Frankie had the Baker Boys, he had Julio and Tony, he had a couple radio guys, and so they were in the pool, and me and the Beat Junkies were in the pool. We used to meet up I think every 2 weeks. We had meetings every 2 weeks up in LA at Frank's spot, and that's how I met Julio. And one day Babu and I, we were we had a DMC competition coming up. And so, you know, we used to just take our bags everywhere. We knew there were going to be turntables so we could practice. So after the meeting wraps up one day, Babu and I are just like, we're showing the other fellas in the pool our routines. Like, hey, like, what do you guys think of these sets? You know, we're doing our thing. And little did we know, Julio was standing behind us in the room. And so he told me this personally, that he saw me do my routine. And then, you know, fast forward not too much further along, he gets this opportunity to be an on-air personality 5 days a week. And so prior to that, he was DJing for Eazy-E's Ruthless Radio Show on Saturday nights. But he called me and he's like, Mel, he's like, man, I need a DJ. He's like, I can't be on the air and DJ 5 nights a week. You know what I'm saying? You want to come rock? I'm like, psh. That's like a no-brainer, man. Like being on the air is like a fucking rock star back in those days. Yeah. I was fucking major opportunity.
He remembered hearing that routine and shit.
Yeah. And so, you know, I had to make a kind of like an audition mix or whatever for the program directors and stuff there.
But you guys grew up on him, right?
Yeah.
Grew up to this shit. Yeah.
And no, 92.3 to
beat. You guys.
I'm more in the later 90s. Like Mr. Chalk was for me, but for P-Dot, he was like, yeah, Melo-D was my guy.
Oh, word. Okay. Yeah.
No, 92.3 to beat was everything for me growing up. Like I grew up early to mid-90s, so okay. For me, like, it was you, Kubichi.
Yeah.
I remember Theo.
Yep, Theo. 92.3. Yeah. John London in the house party.
Yeah, John London in the house party.
Theo was the Asian dude, right?
Yeah.
I remember him from, like, MTV.
He sounded black. Everyone thought he was black.
He had a real deep voice.
Kind of like
talked
crooked.
Like Barry White.
Yeah, I remember that shit. Nah, he sounded like real. He sounded like the dude from Boys to Men.
Yeah, he was super deep voice.
He was like baritone. Yeah.
He would do, like, movie voiceovers, all kind of stuff.
He got famous, and then, like, all the chicks were, like, bummed out that he was Asian or some shit.
Because he showed up at Summer Jam one year.
Yeah, and everyone, like,
and everyone was like, who the fuck is this on stage? No one knew what he looked like. They finally put a face to the name, and
Theo had fans. For sure it caught everyone off guard, like, yo, like, he's Japanese, you know what I'm saying? Like, whoa.
But 92.3, because at the time, I guess I don't want to say as big, but Power wasn't like the main thing to me in LA. It was all about the beat.
Yeah. So Power wasn't as popping back then, right?
Nah, not at all. Like, I think Big Boy wasn't even doing the morning show yet. He was still doing nights.
Yeah, the Baker Boys were doing the mornings for years,
so,
a number of years.
So were you juggling the radio? Were you doing college parties as well?
I was a full-time student, and I was doing a decent amount of mobile DJing, and I was working
the radio.
Yeah, doing the radio, and prior to officially landing my gig at the radio with Julio, I was working as a bank teller at Wells Fargo.
Jesus.
So yeah.
Charles of Wells Fargo.
Great. So it's crazy, man. I was just talking about this the other day. So my commute, again, I used to stay at home with my folks in Cerritos. I moved out years later, but I would commute from Cerritos to Orange County, which is like 25 miles south, right? Go to school. Mm-hmm. School gets out 3:00. Boom. Drive back to Cerritos, drop off my backpack, switch it up with my DJ bag, get my bag of records, drive north all the way up to Hollywood 5 nights a week and do the radio. And then the show would go till like 10.
Was it in Hollywood or was it in Burbank?
The first station was in Hollywood. Okay. It was a really like small, just kind of rinky-dink building off of Yucca and Franklin.
Oh,
Yucca and Cahuenga right there. And yeah, this is early on in the beat, and so that's where it was. And then when the beat started to gain some more success, we moved to a really nice corporate office on Wilshire, the E Entertainment building, I think, across from the La Brea Tar Pits. And that's when they really like stepped up.
Holy shit! So you got 4 hours of sleep every day, almost, right?
Five or six. Yeah, I was definitely grinding hard though, for sure.
That's crazy.
I couldn't do that shit today.
That's why you did it in the early years. You're supposed to do that shit.
Yeah, but those are special times, man. And I don't regret any of it, like, at all. It was fucking...
In 95, you were on the radio. Then it leads up to one of your biggest breaks ever, which is Vibe TV, right?
yeah. No, that was a... Man, I was bummed
Vibe
that ended.
Vibe TV show.
That was fun.
Let's paint the picture here. It's 1997, yeah. Right? It's mm-hmm. Vibe magazine was popular.
Vibe was big at the time.
Yep. If y'all don't know, Vibe magazine was by Quincy Jones, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it was on one of the most infamous like TV channels of all time, UPN.
Yeah, UPN.
Right? So you was on UPN.
Yeah,
you was part of UPN history, man.
Yeah, man.
So you was on Vibe TV on UPN, right? And then who was the host? Sinbad? No,
Chris Spencer, right?
Chris Spencer
was the first host.
Yes.
And then Sinbad came on afterwards, right?
Yeah, I think Chris was there for maybe a couple months, 2 or 3 months. And I don't know, man. Looking back, I feel like they should have just rolled it. They should have just rode it out with Chris, because he was really about the show. He had good heart. You know what I mean? He worked really hard on it, and he was trying to always get better and improve. You know what I mean? And live studio, like, you know, live audience and stuff. Right. That's mad pressure,
but then,
man. Like,
and then nobody really knew who he was at the time.
Yeah. So, and then I don't exactly know like why they went with Sinbad, but I mean, you know, not to throw Sinbad under the bus, but honestly, like when he came through, like he fucked up the whole show, man.
Really?
Like, he ruined that shit for everybody. He would show up late, like, you know, because Chris used to walk around. Like, we would film this on the CBS lot, television lot in Culver City. And so Chris used to come out, like, you know, talk to everybody, like, what do you think of this idea? And he was just good people, man.
Right.
Sinbad, motherfucker, would roll up, show up late, like, go straight to his dressing room, wouldn't talk to nobody. And I don't know, man. He was not Sinbad. Yeah, seriously. Sinbad, man. I don't know, man. Like, you know, I'm not trying to diss Sinbad. I'm not hating on Sinbad, but just like, damn.
God damn it, Sinbad. You know what I mean? Fucking
you can say whatever you want, but don't talk shit about Sinbad, all right? Just don't do that.
No, I'm not putting it on him, but I'm just saying, like, he had a different way
of it. But it was like an Arsenio Hall shit. It was similar.
That's kind of the vibe they were going for.
Like,
you know what I'm saying?
Hall.
But like, we had, you know, we didn't have, you know, A-listers every night.
Were the band?
I was part of the band.
So when they would go to commercial, they'd be like, Melo-D, kick it.
Well, we had a band. Sometimes they would give me a solo.
Melo-D, kick it. Ah, yes.
Oh, kick it like Arsenio used to do.
Melo-D, kick it. Give me some of that fussy old grandma mother shoe shit.
Arsenio was the man.
So, how did you get this gig?
So, I was on the radio at the time, and Quincy Jones apparently was auditioning DJs to be a DJ for this band. And the Baker
and
Boys.
This is a big deal, right? You're like, oh shit.
To me,
Vibe magazine. No, I can imagine, I can imagine at that time, Vibe magazine was like huge. Mm-hmm. And then we were like, oh shit. Like,
yeah, it's a Quincy Jones. Yo, Quincy Jones production.
Jones,
like,
it's going to be
legit.
Like,
they're filming it at like a, you know, bona fide like TV lot.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
The Baker Boys were on Power 106 at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was at home one Friday night, and Eric V, one of the Baker Boys, calls me and tells me that they are just leaving the CBS lot. Like, you know, they auditioned for this DJ slot mm-hmm. in the band for this Vibe TV show. And Quincy Jones was asking, hey, you know any other DJs? Submit some names. Mm-hmm. So
I mean,
they threw my name in.
That was really cool of them. Huh?
Yeah. They put my name in the hat. And he's like, yo, man. He's just like, yeah, you know, we're telling him about you. You got to check out this kid, Melo-D. He's on 92.3 The Beat. And so sure enough, he's like, man, they're going to call you. I was like, okay, cool. And then they call me the next day, and they wanted me to come in that afternoon.
Mm.
So I show up to the CBS lot, and I end up auditioning for Quincy Jones and Greg Villengains. Like, just them two in the room.
The fucking pressure.
Yeah, it was a very high pressure moment. And I remember,
do you remember what routine you did?
So I did, again, this is like when we're competing. So I started off doing like some of my battle routines, right? And I could just tell they weren't vibing. And then in the end, what ended up, I think, hooking them was I did that James Brown routine, would give it up and turn it loose, because that was like some music they could relate to.
Right,
and again, I was just rocking doubles back and forth, you know, Beat Junkie style, you know, needle dropping, like going through different parts, mm-hmm. finding the breaks and stuff. And then so I stopped, and then he came up, he's like, man, you got the job. Like, so they gave it to me right down the spot. And I was like,
how long was your routine?
Probably 6-7 minutes, something like that. Mm-hmm. But like yeah, 30, yeah, if I wouldn't, because I could tell I was like they weren't interested in the first like couple things I
but
was
that,
doing.
But that James Brown routine is amazing, bro.
Oh, it's, thanks, man. It's just like
should be pressed up in on iTunes for $1.99.
It's got to be on YouTube. It's got to be on YouTube somewhere, right?
I've put enough on my Instagram.
Yeah, yeah.
A while back,
dude. But, it's fucking crazy.
Thanks, man.
Yeah. So then Quincy Jones was like, "You got the job."
Yeah, yeah. Right there, they hired me on the spot.
So what were your duties?
So we had.
Were you styled? Did you have like a wardrobe?
Yeah,
like a
no. From? We had wardrobe like every day. You know,
so,
this
wait,
is like
so wait, I got a good question. Like, you got to keep this shit 100
for sure.
Were you kind of feeling yourself? You were like, yo, I'm on Vibe TV.
Yeah, I was like, yo, I'm
fucking rocking.
I'm on the radio.
Yeah. Quincy Jones hired me. Yeah. Come on, man.
I'm not feeling myself. It was definitely a very exciting time. You know what I mean? I just.
How old were you?
I was 20. 3-24
You were filling yourself.
He was a cocky motherfucker, wasn't he?
I hope I wasn't. But to be honest, man, like, yeah, I was, you know, between the radio and doing that show, like, that was able to afford me to buy my very first house at age 25.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So I saved up all that paper.
And 25?
In Cerritos, yeah.
It's kind of 25. Wow.
Yeah, so. Shout out to Vibe.
Smart man. So, who told you to get a house?
My folks, they weren't kicking me out, but I was confined to one bedroom. I have my bedroom, and I have two younger sisters.
And you're like, fuck this! I'm on Vibe TV, I'm getting my own
I'm
house.
On TV.
No, actually, I want to say it was my parents. Like, my parents kind of planted that seed with me. Like, you should think about buying your own house. You know,
that's
what I mean,
awesome.
They saw that I was making good money and stuff, and so I was like, okay. So I work with this local realtor, and she took me around for probably like 7 or 8 months. Before I settled on the house where I lived, actually just moved from there, just sold that house. But I was there from, I bought it in 2000. I bought it in 2000 and just sold it. We just moved out end of April.
Wow.
So, yeah.
Almost 20 years.
Yeah.
You made some good money.
Holy shit.
You made some good money on that
house.
It's like, it's not bad, right?
The crazy thing, my friend just bought a house in Cerritos like a month ago, so I don't know if it's the same house, but yeah.
Tell me, all you motherfuckers that are popping right now and doing the new Vibe TV and on the all your motherfuckers who's killing it right now, y'all need to do what Melo did and get that house.
Yeah, exactly, man.
Yeah, that's fucking great. I love hearing shit like that.
Did you have any crazy guests on the radio? Like, I mean, just memorable, legendary stuff?
Oh, you name them. Anyone and everyone came through. Like, definitely all the West Coast icons from Dr. Dre, Ice Cube, Snoop,
so
Eminem.
You were on the radio 95. This
95.
Was the heat. This is the heat of East West.
I remember Jay-Z came through when he dropped Dead Presidents.
Ooh.
Yeah. So he came through. I mean, even, some of the OG hip-hop heads... Or hip hop artists, De La Soul. I mean, you name it, man. Everyone came through. R&B, Mariah Carey, Janet Jackson. People were putting out records, and anytime they had a record, a new album out, they had to promote it.
Yeah.
And the beat was pretty large at the time, so they had to come through. Like, we were kind of like the LA urban station. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're making a lot of noise, so they had to come fuck with us. So,
how was the climate during the East Coast, West Coast shit?
Yeah, that was, it got pretty intense, man. I remember when, I think you guys know.
For those who don't know what I'm talking about, the East Coast, West Coast between like Tupac and Biggie.
Yeah,
probably mid '90s, right?
Yeah, 95 or 96.
What set that off? I remember this was when Tupac dropped "Hit 'Em Up."
Yeah,
and we were told not to play it, and Julio, of course, he plays it. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you guys that don't know Julio, he's always just represented the West Coast. He's always like just got behind the West Coast, like new artists, you know what I mean, like artists that have been in the game for years. He's always just supported their music. So and he has relationships with all these guys, and they respect him, and so he plays "Hit 'Em Up," and I'll never forget, the program director runs in the studios like, kill that shit. Oh yeah, because that was, I mean, he's fucking banging Marcus. Hard like on Biggie and on Puff, you know what I'm saying? And so and then the calls start coming in. I want to say there was like some death threats that came through. But then, of course, like, you know, the kids out in the street, like the heads, like the West Coast heads, like they would call in and request it. You know what I'm saying? And
wait,
so
who were the people that were doing death threats?
I don't know. Just random heads from the street, or maybe people. Yeah. I mean, I never personally got a death threat, but like they would call the radio station and make threats. I remember, in fact, one time there was a bomb scare. Yeah, because over "Hit 'Em Up."
Really?
Yeah. If my memory serves me correctly, and we didn't find this out till later.
Wow. I just remember that time because when I have friends that don't know any better or not from LA, they're like, yo, what was it like? And they're like thinking we were like riding for it. And I'm like, yo, it was kind of a scary time.
Yeah, it was.
Like, it wasn't like you might think. Like, people were like kind of like on edge, like, damn, he might have went a little too far with this. Like,
it was
weird.
So there was actually some people on the West Coast that was like kind of offended by the record.
No, it was more like people that like probably, I don't know, they were supportive of the East Coast, or maybe they came from the East Coast and moved to the West Coast.
I mean, I'm sure there must have been some Biggie fans on the West Coast.
For sure.
I was a Bad Boy fan. And I just think they were just like, yo, New York, like, what
was,
the fuck?
New York was hot. I just felt like everybody in the West Coast is riding for Tupac.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, he quickly became, you know what I mean, kind of like the man, you know what I'm saying, on the West. But yeah, I was always a fan of Biggie. Like, New York was hot. Like, at 96, 97, like, man, dropping albums, like, you know what I mean? Like, this, joints coming out of.
Yeah, because that was like towards the end of the Death Row era. It's everybody had left by then. So.
Right.
The politics on the radio, you couldn't play Hit 'Em Up. And was that pissing off Death Row or like any of the people?
Did Suge Knight come see you?
Suge Knight came through a few times, but. Anytime Suge came through the station, it was just like whatever Suge wanted, like Suge got. You know what I'm saying? I was never. Hey,
I get it.
I was never privy to those meetings. I met him once. I forget what year it was, but it's probably around that time. And then he came to a club one night. I was DJing DJ AM's old club in Hollywood. Just randomly, he fell through late night and LAX. Came over to the DJ booth. LAX.
Yeah.
He came up to the DJ booth and said, "What's up?" And, "Oh, what's up, Suge?" You know, he was cool. He was cool. Yeah. But he was cool. And then I started playing just some Death Row music, and I think he appreciated that. So nice. Yeah. But
still out here.
Yeah, it was definitely an intense time. If you're around for those years, and I remember one year at the Summer Jam. Damn, I don't remember what year it was. There was this huge fight. It was two neighborhoods.
Summer Jam in LA. Crips. Right?
Well, the Summer Jam was always at the Irvine.
Yeah, because when you say Summer Jam, people think New York one right away.
Oh, okay. No. This is the one in LA for the beat. Yeah. But there was a huge fight, man. It ended the whole concert. And
I remember that. I think I was around like 11 or 12.
Yeah, that was gnarly.
I think my older sister was there.
Yeah.
She said it was crazy.
Yeah, what fight between who?
It was just two neighborhoods. Yeah. I think it was Bloods and Crips or two. Yeah, I think it was Bloods and Crips. Yeah.
Shit. Damn.
But there was like, I mean, it was just, you know, like LA is just like, you know, with the beat, it was always, our audience was primarily Black and Mexican. Mm-hmm. So it was crazy, man. You would have like, I mean, Irvine Meadows, I don't know if you ever went to a show, but like, it was like 17,000 people and it was sell out every year.
Yeah.
And so it's just all these different like neighborhoods. You have Crips, you have Bloods. You have like, you know, the Mexicans from like Pomona, SGV, mm-hmm. like the neighborhoods, they were always there. Like, yeah, it was like, it was tense, man. I mean, we were always backstage.
Do you know who was performing that year?
Oh man,
was it 95?
We did so many of those. Well, I didn't. I think my first Summer Jam was 96.
Okay,
but I want to say that incident was probably 97. I want to say it was like the second Summer Jam that I ever did. It was probably 97 if I had to guess.
It was crazy, man. Yeah. Like, they would live it. They would do like a live broadcast.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. The first year.
I would sit in my house because I was too young to go and just listen to a live broadcast.
Yeah,
the very first 95. Junior Mafia was actually performing.
Really?
At, Summer Jam in LA. Yeah, that sounds
accurate.
That sounds nervous though. No.
I think at the time there was no beef, so the fact that they're out there, no one really, it wasn't a thing.
But that I remember, was before the beef.
Yeah, 95 was like. Before they.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Before that shit happened in the studio.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So remember that's when when Get Money just came out.
Right.
Because the Get Money remix is what.
Set it off.
Yeah, that sparked it off, right?
Yeah,
because he rhymed off of it. Hit him up.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it's right before that shit. Huh? Wow.
Yeah. Same loop. Yeah.
I think even loop. To Live and Die in L.A. That excerpt is from the beat, right?
Where the girl is talking. Oh, it is. That's Dominique De Prima. That's right.
Fucking your wife. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
That's from the.
That's Dominique De Prima. She was one of the on-air personalities.
What was her name again?
Dominique De Prima.
Yeah.
She had her show was Street Science.
Mm-hmm. She's like Street Science on air.
Yeah. So. That's right. Dang. Yeah. Now those are. I mean, regardless. I mean, you know, it did get tense, but man, looking back, like those were good times, man. Like the radio, like we just had full creative freedom. You know, we were getting paid to DJ on the air, like handsomely at that. And I mean, we could play whatever the hits were from the East Coast, the West Coast, and then like, you know, we would have our gimmies. And for me personally, they kind of just let me do my thing. You know what I mean? As long as I just kept it within reason, I didn't abuse it. You know what I'm saying? So it's funny, like when I step out and I talk to people that grew up in LA, you know what I'm saying, and maybe they're DJ now or they just listen to the radio, they don't remember me playing the hits, like to get money, unless I was freaking it somehow. They remember me playing like the indie hip hop stuff because I would push that really hard. You know what I mean? Because like I said, this is like, you know, with the Beat Junkies, being a Beat Junkie and stuff, like, right. We were always in Fat Beats buying those records. Yeah. And so, you know, I had the outlet and the platform to do it. So I always tried to squeeze those in the mix. And those are the ones that people remember. Those are like the standouts, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, because like you guys had like, what do you call it? Like the Beat Junkie, what would you call them? Like compilation volume ones and twos?
Oh,
and
so those are mixtapes.
Mixtapes.
Yes, so we had volume 1, 2, and 3, and those
were those some of the first joints on Wax though that you guys pushed out, or
like the actual songs that were featured on the mix, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah,
that was Pete, you were saying those were on Wax, right? The volume 1s and 2s and 3s.
Yeah, vinyl, cassette, and CD. Yeah, wow, and those were being sold like everywhere, all over
you
the
guys
world. Tower Records.
Did you guys distribute?
No, that was actually done through another independent label called Blackberry, mm-hmm. and that was run by a guy named I think his name was Matt. God, so long ago, but that was his label, and so he basically paid us to do the mix. You know,
so it was basically like a live mixtape. I'm trying to think. What's the most similar thing to this? Like a Funkmaster Flex when he came out with his Volume 1.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it was like it was basically like a mix of all this underground,
right?
Indie artists,
correct. But and done West Coast style though.
West Coast,
mixing,
yeah.
Like the 8-bar blends.
But you were DJing the new songs like a mixtape, pretty much, and then doing the Beat Junkie juggles,
right. Rocking doubles, cutting a little bit here and there.
Yeah.
Not too much mic work. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like,
so it
you
was
know,
like no original music. It was like every these records came out already.
Those were releases. They were releases on some majors, but for the most part, they were indie releases. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
when you guys released something like that, like who were some of the artists that were popping around then? This is probably a little late. Like Arsonist, was that?
Arsonist, Mos Def, mm-hmm. Artifacts, Beat Nuts, yeah.
Company Flow, like
Company
all of
Flow, yeah.
That was like that whole
exactly.
era, right?
High and the
yeah.
Mighty,
right. Shout out to Mighty Mai, yeah.
Mighty Mai, where you at? Yeah.
So wait, when you guys released the like Volume 1, Volume 2, and then how long were you guys went on? How long were you on the radio?
I was on the beat from 95 till 2002.
Wow.
And then
because we were doing research with you online. And there seems to be like a gap around 2000 to 2005.
Sounds like
for radio,
for just for any information on like
it's
like you took
on
a
the
nap.
Majority of the Beat Junkies. Or no, it just wasn't like documented or anything was going on.
Oh, okay. Maybe. Yeah, we were all still very active in the early 2000s.
Yeah, I'm sure you guys didn't vacation for 5 years.
But I actually ended up going with Julio to another radio station in 2003. I think we did like a year and a half or two. It was called Hot 92, and we had a specialty show on Saturday nights called Aqua Boogie, which was all 80s funk, R&B.
Oh, wow.
And again, this is pre-Serato, so, you know, and I'm record digging like every week, you know, buying records, and now I'm like, you know,
is that
trying to like
the time that they flipped, that the beat flipped?
Exactly. Yeah. That's exactly when it was.
Wait, what did the beat flip to?
I don't remember. What happened?
What happened was the corporation that owned 92.3 The Beat was Clear Channel, right? And they had like 300 plus radio stations across the country. Mm-hmm. And then they had this other corporation from Atlanta called Radio One. Yeah. And the deal was the Beat sold the actual name, the Beat, mm-hmm. to this Radio One corporation. But they said, we're keeping the 92.3 The Beat signal, but we're going to give you this other 100.3. So we're going to give you this 100.3 radio station, and we're going to give you the Beat. You can do
what
you want with
happened.
It,
remember,
but we're
yeah.
keeping the 92.3.
Why did they do that?
Because the 92.3 was where the juice was at. That was the better signal. 100.3, you couldn't get it all up and down Southern California.
But why would they sell the name of it?
They just didn't want to do it anymore, I guess. I don't know the whole backstory, but they ended up going this other direction, and they pulled actually pretty much all of the existing team from 92.3 The Beat over to Hot 92. So they just kind of reformatted, you know what I mean, and went to like an old school radio station. But that was fun too, man. Like I had a lot of fun doing that mix with Julio.
Just doing old school shit.
Yeah. Just like filling holes in my collection, like certain 12 inches, like I didn't have two copies of, you know what I'm saying? Disco mm-hmm. breaks, funk, R&B, 80s classics, a little bit of like early hip hop, like 80s hip hop, but for the most part, it was like funk and R&B.
Do you still dig once in a while?
Once in a while, yeah. I don't record shop as much as I used to, but
enjoy that shit?
I get caught up when I go to record stores.
Really?
I'll get caught up for hours, man, and I'll end up spending a gang of dough.
I used to hate digging, yo.
Really?
Seriously?
I used to love that shit, man. I loved it, man. Me and J Rock, we would go to I don't know if you guys had this in the East Coast, but we would have like record fairs, record swap meets that would happen.
Yeah, the beat swap meet.
Yeah. So
we were in New York, used to have like hotels. They used to have like they used to have in a ballroom have record sales.
Different vendors, right?
Like once a month. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. So you all have the same stuff.
I just hate when I hated like looking for something, going to like four record shops and not finding it.
I used to love hated that.
You should always call ahead, right?
I loved it, man.
I would like look and I'd be like, fuck, they don't have it. I went over there, they don't have it.
You guys remember going like in 93 and buying like the Wu-Tang and the Midnight Marauders album on the same day when it came out? Y'all didn't do that?
I remember that, yeah.
Damn, I did.
Rock and Soul.
Yeah, man.
I was looking so.
Yeah. I was in high school. I wasn't doing that shit yet.
Yeah, you're chasing girls. It's okay.
Yeah, I still buy records. The last time I bought records was the last Beat Swap Meet. Yeah, I just bought some 45s, some hip hop 45s. But it sucks because now it's like you guys are hip to Discogs, I assume, right? Everyone knows about Discogs.
Yeah.
So it just sucks because that like kind of sets the bar as far as the prices. So back in the day, you know what I'm saying? You can find records for $1, $2. Like, ooh, what? Okay, $1. Oh, dude, it's just like, yeah, they set the bar. So now it's like, you know, a 45. Like, man, I spent $75 on a Reckless 45.
But it's also hard to find, like, 45 hip-hop records as well.
Yeah, for sure, Yeah. So, I mean.
Do you guys know what the Discogs is?
I have no.
Yeah, Discogs is like an online
Eddie
site.
Eddie put me on.
Yeah, for, like, basically vinyl.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's become, like, this. What would you call it? Like, the StockX? Like, the eBay?
So they kind of set the bar for prices.
They set the bar for prices. Yeah. So, like, there would be some, like, you know, like, a lot of record store and vinyl owners, they don't know, like, you know, like, common sense, the bitch in you. They don't know worth. That's a rare record, you know? But then, you know, if they research it on Discogs, they'd be like, oh, shit. Like,
it's worth this.
Discogs is selling it for this much. Okay, I'm going to sell it for that much,
They're
going
to price it up there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They mark it up. So, but yeah, they have, you can find anything on Discogs from, you know what I mean, the things that were major commercial releases to, like, things that are super rare.
But the only problem with them is also it's a gamble because you never know. You might order something, then you get that 45 or record, and it might be all scratched up.
Yeah, I personally never bought anything, but I do a lot of research on there for the record pool.
Mm-hmm.
But I've never actually ordered from Discogs. I know J Rock does.
I've ordered a couple of times, and like only a few times I had like a problem with the record was warped or it was scratched a little bit.
Okay. But
so what happens? Do you give the guy like 2 stars or some shit?
Just like give him 1 star.
But you'll get your money back, right?
I just like, fuck it, I took an L.
Yeah. Charges to the game, never.
Yeah.
Because that shit could have happened in transit, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It could have been more.
It could have been that, yeah.
Yeah, it's also the seller's responsibility. They got to package that shit correctly, you know what I'm saying?
A lot of it's like overseas also, so yeah.
Anything could have happened.
Yeah, that's true,
I
remember digging, and I used to love digging for samples and digging for soul.
Yeah.
I just did not like digging for like when you were trying to find the records that you needed. Like for the clubs, because it was just like really, and it was just the most annoying and just like tedious shit where you just had to go from here to here and check in the stores.
So I'm just curious. Cause I just hated that.
I used to like it, man.
I never really spent time in New York in the 90s, and I assume you guys were DJing clubs. What was the sound back in the clubs? Like, so this is like the tunnel, right? Y'all had the tunnel.
I have no idea what was going on in the 90s.
It was a bunch. It was like the tunnel. It was Palladium.
Palladium. Yeah.
Oh man, it's like a bunch of.
It's a ton.
But what you saying? Like,
you know
what?
You know what's actually a good
like,
episode?
As far as like the records that were being played, and that's like Flex, right?
I mean,
like,
everything.
You know, like Flex was doing the clubs.
Like the mid '90s was like all Biggie, Tribe.
You know, we just aired an episode with Ellie Escobar and Goldfinger.
Okay.
That's the one you want to listen to because we literally break down the 2 decades. Like we did the '90s in New York and in the 2000s and the club scene and what was going on.
So about an hour or two, like an hour and a half of just that.
Oh, dope. Some
honestly,
history.
With
some
that with that episode, we could have gone another 2 hours just talking about the history of New York and what the fuck was going on.
Exactly,
The episode could have been 5 hours, but I could have 3 something.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I always wondered the same thing because a lot of DJs coming up, I mean, a lot of DJs, West Coast DJs that we've had here, particularly like Cali DJs, LA DJs that we've had on this podcast, right? They said they're coming up was they weren't really playing hip hop. There weren't any hip hop clubs.
Like who?
A lot of them, like they were just
Vice.
They were playing. They had to play house music. They had to DJ in raves because there was no real hip hop. And I think
there was.
I think Vice told me about one DJ Icy Ice. Mm-hmm. I think he was one of the only dudes that really had a long term hip hop party.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And but everything else was like all these other DJs were going like even. Remember Mega Man was saying him and Cyber Kid would have to like do raves in order to DJ, but they couldn't really play hip hop.
Even on the DJ AM documentary, it shows him just going to raves in the beginning.
So I always like a lot of the DJs now who are like, you know, who are around, I guess in my generation or whatever, a lot of them came up having to DJ raves when they didn't want to.
Right.
And then
that was really the only outlet.
It was the only outlet. DJing. And then I didn't really know to I didn't know Icy Ice till I think Vice mentioned it.
Yeah, I've never heard of him.
Yeah, he's one of the Beat Junkies also.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the original
he's
Beat Junkies.
He's one of you guys.
Yeah.
And then so I wanted to know more about that, what his party, okay. because no one ever talks about it.
Yeah, that's a huge part of LA culture. So,
because you guys don't even know about that shit.
I think I was a little too young, me and Jamie both.
I was 1989.
Icy Ice had a his mobile group was Legend Entertainment. Mm-hmm. And so they were based out of Carson. And so, you know, he had his squad, maybe they were 15, 20 deep. But same thing, he started kind of doing like mobile house parties and all the same gigs we used to do. But he started doing this 18 and over club. And it was primarily like, it was mostly Filipinos, because Ice is Filipino. But he used to host it at this place called the Variety Arts Center in downtown, which was a four-story building. And same thing, he would get 800, 1,000 kids. It was like every Thursday night, I think.
Wow,
and so this is, like 90, this is early 90s, like 92 to like 94, 91 to like 94. But that shit was cracking. And then they started doing like gigs in other kind of like big locations, big halls and stuff like that. But he had a huge following. At a certain point, it got so big, they started bringing out acts. So I know they had like they had Ronnie O and Joe Cooley one night. Man, I'm drawing a blank right now, but I definitely know like that second or third summer they were bringing out like some A-listers as far as like performances and stuff. But yeah, I had a huge following, and we played everything in there. We played some freestyle, like Miami bass music that we all grew up on. We played New Jack Swing. We played like 80s, like Lisa, and then we also played new hip hop. So like, you know, Mad Lion, Tribe, Award Tour, like all the records of Wu-Tang, like all that stuff. So we played everything in there. That was fun.
How long did that party last?
Oh man, I want to say at least three years.
Three years.
Yeah, and then, no, actually, they kept it going definitely longer than that, because they went from Variety Arts Center, and then towards the mid to late 90s, they moved it to another spot called Arena, which is equally as large. It was a huge room, held like 1,000 people, had a big balcony. And so they were there for another two, maybe 3 years. So, and then they did, I think it's called the Avalon now in Hollywood. Same thing, huge venue. Man, now that I think about it, probably like 7-8 years, something like that.
Wow.
And they just kind of moved locations. But that shit was legendary, man. Yeah, yeah, they used to pack the house, and that shit was rocking.
What was what was something called Unity?
Oh, so Unity. So that was kind of like the hip hop, like the underground night, where like, you know, it's like strictly like hip hop, like rap. So
this year
like,
was this?
This is Unity. Unity's like 90. I might be off a little bit here, but that's 95 to like 98, maybe 99. And it's funny, the guy that called me Mark Love, like he was the resident DJ earlier. Shout out to Mark Love. But like, yeah, that was just straight like boom bap hip hop.
So it was like backpack hip hop.
Backpack hip hop. Yeah. But I mean, you know, this is again Wu-Tang. So you would hear Ice Cream in there. You would hear East Coast and West Coast. But it was strictly a rap night. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, yeah, yeah. But that shit was cracking too.
So there was some like hip hop.
There was. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
But so, but I guess there wasn't that wide of a scene, a big enough a scene for various DJs to get on and just kind of come up on, right?
Yeah, Vice was always he was always kind of more of kind of like a party DJ, you know what I mean? He could play hip hop too, you know what I'm saying? He would get busy a little bit, but he, you know, it's funny, like you look at where he's at now and it makes total sense, because I you know, dude, so Vice was also part of that Ghetto Baby record pool. So he was, it's funny, man, that's where I met him. And he wasn't even old enough to drive. I think he was 15 and I was probably like 19, something like that. But Frankie, like he was basically Frankie's assistant. And Frankie'd be like, go pick up these records. And so I remember like we would jump in Vice. I think he had a Volkswagen Bug, like a blue Bug. And he didn't even have a license, yo. And so we're rolling around LA like oh, you shouldn't be driving right now. But then he started DJing. He gets on the radio. And yeah, but then he starts doing like you know, these parties, like clubs, you know what I'm saying? Like we're playing top 40. He's playing a little bit of hip hop too, whatever's being played on the radio. And then, you know, early on, he's, you know, how he rocks now. Like he's always on the mic and stuff. He's that dude, man. So but he would come around, he would come to the Legend parties with man, his old partner Splice, and what's the dude? Neil. forget his DJ name, but they would roll through once in a while, yeah. And like he would drop a set and stuff like that, and then we used to like intersect. You know, we would cross paths. Like, you know, we would do some of the same clubs together. Every once in a while, I would catch a gig where he was DJing, and it would be like more of one of his style gigs where mm-hmm. I'm playing a top 40 set too, along next to him and stuff like that. So yeah, he was always in the mix, man. But there definitely was outlets for everything. It's just like maybe they didn't happen as frequently,
right?
You know what I'm saying? But like Unity was definitely like that was a staple in LA for sure. Legend Entertainment. It was called The Source. That was the name of the night. The Source.
It's a good name for a spot.
Yeah. Shout out to Legend Icy Ice. Yeah. Original Beat Junkie. And Icy Ice's younger sister, Symphony, was also a Beat Junkie, and she was, she was battling too. She started DJing on the beat with us in the later 90s. So yeah, man, those were good times. Yeah, wow. We definitely had a good scene out there.
As a unit, the whole Beat Junkies, you guys, I mean, you got Babu, who was part of Dilated Peoples, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And it was probably around late 90s when they were probably blowing up too, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. And then Jurassic 5. And then did you guys tour with like Cypress Hill? And
so we did a radio show on the beat called Soul Assassins. And uh-huh. that was myself, Retmatic, and Babu. This is a specialty show every Friday night. But same time, this is like late 90s. So we're playing just underground hip hop, like boom bap stuff. Right. You know what I'm saying? So that was the show. Rhett has a side project with Bobo, who plays percussion. And it's called Retmatic versus Bobo. And so he's toured with Bobo, but I don't think he's ever toured with Cypress Hill. But yeah, that was pretty much the only capacity that I can remember where we worked directly with Cypress. But those are the homies, like Bobo and Be Real, like, you know, the homies right there.
But so you've also done shows, like you've done shows with like various artists. I'm just going to list a couple. And they're like a wide range of motherfuckers. Mm-hmm. And I want to know if this is accurate because we found this on
Wikipedia.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, somewhere on there.
No Doubt.
Yeah.
Eminem.
Mm-hmm.
James Brown.
Yep.
Aaliyah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna go back to the Aaliyah one, but yeah. Ludacris.
Ludacris. Yep.
And then Katy Perry.
Katy Perry. That was out here.
Really?
Yeah. That was at Wasted Space. You remember Wasted Space?
Yeah.
At the Hard Rock.
The Hard Rock.
Yeah.
Wait. What was that?
It was kind of like a rock.
It was like a venue.
Rock bar.
Yeah. Rock bar. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I remember that.
This is the one she got hot like in 2008.
This was right before she blew up. So this is what was that first? Kissed a girl.
Yeah, 2007.
Around 2007. Maybe.
Presto had a residency there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It was me and Presto.
Mm-hmm. They had like a bunch of TVs there.
I think so.
Maybe behind
it was
the
like
bar.
That shit used to go off though. Like dark.
Wasted Space. It was rock.
Sid Vicious used to DJ there.
It was really small.
Sid Vicious, yeah.
Oh, it was like a rock bar, right?
Yeah, it was a rock bar.
Yeah.
The format was strictly rock. I mean, I think they opened it up like maybe a year later. But like for the first year, like, yo, we were like just playing straight rock.
I remember.
That show was kind of fun.
There's like a drummer set or band next to the DJ booth.
Yeah,
right?
They had a little stage, so that's where Katy Perry performed, and so they had me DJ for her.
Yeah,
you know what I mean, bring her out and all that stuff. Like, yeah. So that was her.
So then, wait, what was this Aaliyah thing?
So that's Vibe TV.
Ooh.
So she came and did, if you guys remember Hot Like Fire, remember that song?
Yeah.
So we would film the TV show 4 days a week. We filmed Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and we filmed two on Thursday, and we had Fridays off. So we would get on set like, I don't know, 11, maybe like noon, and then we would work until 6 p.m. And so, you know, anyhow, she comes through, and when anytime we had a musical guest, the band would back up the artist, so we would play their track. So I rehearsed with her, kind of like dialogue with her about ideas, like, you know, what do you think of this? So it's just a real subtle baby scratch, you know what I'm saying? And then the band's obviously playing the music, and so we rehearsed together, and then we performed, and then it aired that night.
Wow.
I wish I had pictures from that stuff, man. I never carried a camera around, and just like looking back now, I was like, damn, like,
just
I have
never
a lot
think
of
about that shit.
Yeah.
So you can't find any of those clips on YouTube?
It might be. There's some Vibe stuff, I think. People have tagged me because we actually did, when we won a battle in 97, we won the world championship for ITF. They actually invited us to perform on the TV show. So I know for sure that one's on YouTube. But
yeah,
there might be some of the musical, the guest stuff out there somewhere. So
Literally through the outlet of Vibe TV, is this where No Doubt and Eminem? And
so Eminem and No Doubt was another TV show that I did called Farm Club. That was the TNT network, and that was the early
another TV show.
Yeah, that was a different TV show, but it was a yeah.
Damn, you're a rock star.
Checks was coming, man.
Jesus, no wonder the house came fast.
Wait. Now I mean, I don't want to get only in business, but how is the checks when you're DJing a TV show?
So I think for Vibe, I was getting, after taxes, it was like $2,800 a week.
How many shows is that?
We recorded five shows.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and so then like I was also doing the radio at the time, and I was getting $1,800 every 2 weeks. And I was DJing five, sometimes six nights a week. I think five nights a week.
That's
at that point.
Really good.
That's really
then,
good
right?
back then.
Yeah. No, for sure.
And you was also doing clubs at the time as well, right?
Yeah, I was doing mobile gigs, and then, you know, we were battling and stuff, so
damn,
we would get booked.
I know motherfuckers
like,
who would do it for that money right now.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, I feel like, you know, this is I had a conversation with DJ Reflex. This is, I don't know, not that long, maybe like 7-8 years ago.
Yeah.
But I remember, like, man, I don't think he was saying DJs don't get paid anything. Like, now the stations, I mean, at least in L.A., I don't know how it is in the East Coast, but I know the personalities, they get a check for sure. But I'm talking like the mix show DJs. Like,
yeah, no, I mean,
in L.A., I don't think they're getting anything. Like, yeah, basically, like,
New York
being
is the
told,
same way, man.
They're being told, you got to try and just flip, you know, you got to try and flip this for yourself. Like, you know what I mean? And just, like, take advantage of the platform.
Doing, well, the guys doing radio for free.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Even out here, like, I don't, yeah.
Just for the platform.
Exactly. Just for for the promotion. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Well, I've heard it's some places, minimum wage.
Yeah.
Damn.
For an hourly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fuck. Yeah, that's crazy.
And then I hear other places are $50 an hour.
Yeah. When I first started, that was my rate. When I first started on the beat in 95, they were giving me $50 a mix. Yeah. And then, yeah. And
that
then
shit added up quick.
Yeah, but then I started DJing more, and then my mix was 30 minutes at first, and then they extended it to an hour, maybe like 2 years in. And then, you know, we started doing mix weekends. We brought in some more DJs, and then we moved into that corporate office.
What's one of the most legendary drops that you have in the cut that you haven't?
Drops, like from an artist? You
yes.
mean? Oh, man. I wish I had. I have some of them, actually, but they're all on carts. We used to play those off of carts. I don't know if you back in the day. Like,
I had intern on radio, but
radio carts.
About,
Julio actually converted some of them for me, but, man, I had everybody.
What do you mean by carts? Like the shit that looks like A-tracks?
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
They, like, plug it in,
machine,
right?
Yeah. And then there's this... plug it into a separate line, and that's how you play the drop on the air. But I had everybody, man. I had Aaliyah, Common, De La Soul, Dilated Peoples.
You gotta dig that shit up.
Everybody, I gotta. There's definitely. I'm missing a good handful of them, but
did
I
you
have
like a Biggie, Tupac.
I had. I didn't have a Tupac.
Do you have a Biggie one?
I think I had a Biggie one. Wow. Yeah, I definitely had a Biggie one. all the West Coast cats, Cube, Dre.
Wow.
Yeah, for sure.
I saw that Dre was holding one of you guys' new vinyl up.
So that's the school record. That's the second volume of the school record I was telling you guys about.
It's a flex. It's just a flex, man.
Yeah. Nice. What's crazy, the story behind that is, so he wanted, I don't know what he wanted it for, but he was looking for It's Time. So one of his producers called me one day. You guys know the record, It's Time, right?
Yeah.
One of his producers, the homie Fred Reck, he called me one day and was just like, yo, he's like, Dre's looking for It's Time. You have your records. I was like, man, mine's in storage. I was like, but I got like 8 copies, you know what I mean? But they're all in storage because I'm in the process of moving.
Right.
So I don't have any of my records in front of me.
And you didn't, so I was like, run to the storage?
What's that?
You didn't run to the storage if Dr. J's looking for a record?
I have to dig it out,
I'm
man.
I'm sprinting there.
And like that specific record, I know it's in a box, and I have like probably close to 100 boxes that are sealed. You know what I mean? Yeah. So I'd have to, there's no way I'm fine. You know what I'm saying? Like, no disrespect to the doc.
Sorry, doc. You have to wait.
So I told Fred, I was just like, yo, it's on the new school record. So he went down and picked it up and gave it to Dre. I don't know if Dre wanted just to practice or if he wanted to record something or whatever, but he was looking for It's Time.
Damn.
And so then just like, you know, just to reciprocate, like he threw us that, he snapped that shot for us.
Shout out to
so
Fred. Right.
Yeah.
I used to, like, he had like some West Coast bangers.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Used to love that dude.
He produced a lot for DPG.
Yeah.
Worked alongside Dre, Chronic 2000. Man. All him, Battle Cat. Fred, yeah.
He produced Calling Out Names, right?
Mm-hmm.
Corrupt.
What's up, Fred?
Yeah.
That was another diss record, too.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Remember that one?
Yeah, he went hard in the paint on that one.
Yeah.
You guys celebrated 20 years to Beat Junkies in
12.
And then I kind of noticed that you guys started really kind of getting organized and pushing the brand further after that.
Yep.
And I was wondering if there was something that kind of happened after the 20 years. I think everyone maybe kind of realized, yo, like maybe after the tour, you guys were like, wow, we've got a huge following, or like we're still able to do this shit. Well, maybe we're not taking advantage of everything that we can. You guys are a little bit older, and you're like,
yeah,
a little bit more business minded.
That's exactly what happened.
That's exactly
how it happened. So prior to doing the 20 year, it was kind of this interesting period for the Beat Junkies, for this crew, where when I was out here, you know, working at Body English, doing the clubs, like, you know, working the scene with y'all, you know, Babu was working with Dilated Peoples, Rhett Maddox touring, you know, month after month with Visionaries.
It seems like the 2000s, you guys kind of all split up a little
bit. Everyone just kind of did their own thing. But we were still really tight, like kept in contact all the time. Like the homies would come out here and kick it with me. I was always going back to LA when I was living here to, like, you know, link up with them and, like, do stuff, whether it was recording or a gig or whatever. So, you know, it was never any love lost. Like, you know, we're all that. I think that's
what's kept us together. I don't think there was beef.
But the anniversary was basically the catalyst for everything that we're doing now.
So you did it 20. It was 20, approaching 20 years, and then, like, you guys are just like, let's just do
a tour and shit.
So I basically called all the fellas and I'm like, man, 20 years, y'all. You know what I'm saying? We should do something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And at first, from J Rock, he's funny. You guys got to know Jay, but he's like, he's real big on not time stamping himself.
Right.
It's like, man, fuck that. Like, 20 years, man. You tell motherfuckers how old we are. Blah, blah, blah. It's like, nah, man. Like, we got to fucking, come on, man. At least in our hometown, you know what I'm saying? We haven't done shit out here for a club or a gig, like, together. Yeah. Like, all of us, like, under one roof for almost a decade, you know what I mean? So I was like, come on, let's make something happen. So so we did it at this it's kind of a legendary venue in LA called the Echoplex, pretty sizable, holds 1,000 people, so we basically made it like we celebrated 20 year anniversary, and it was a showcase night. So we all, like, got up there and did individual sets. We practiced for, I don't know, 2 weeks. We rented out some studio time in the area and put together some routines. LRG floated us a, you know, 20 year anniversary shirt, kind of gifted that to us, and so we sold merch, and it was huge. So, you know, and it got everyone pumped up, and beyond that, like, just to backtrack, like, just, you know, again, us kind of, like, going our own lanes in the years prior, but having to connect in the studio and, like, flush out these routines and, like, you know, brainstorm ideas, kind of, like, reconnected us as DJs on the DJ tip. So it was good to kind of reconnect in that sense. And then we did the show, and then do-over. We actually, there was a whole weekend, so we did our show at the Echoplex, and then we took over the do-over that Sunday. So you know, after the weekend, and, you know what I'm saying,
like, you guys got together, you guys had an epic weekend, it was fun, and then you were like, wow, like, this is dope.
We haven't done this.
So, and then you also kind of saw the reaction from the people. You saw the following come out.
Yeah, like, people are still checking for us. You know what I'm saying?
Like, I'm sure you got, like, a bunch of tweets and Instagram posts, and you were just like, "Yo, there's something here that we've been neglecting."
Yeah, it's crazy. We ended up selling 1,000 seats, and we turned away like 420 something people. Like, walk-ups. I remember pulling up, like, you know, sound check, loading and stuff, and then, like, I think I left to grab some food or something, and came back like before doors were gonna open it, and the shit, I was like, whoop, I'll never forget. This shit was around the fucking block. I was like, damn, this is gonna be sick. Like, that was a real special night for us.
It's such a great thing to me, and I actually want a lot of the younger DJs to hear this, because you know, it's not, I feel like a lot of DJs are going for self, which is a great thing.
Of course.
It's a great thing to, like, nurture your talents and, like, brand yourself and be the star. But I also think there's power in, like, numbers. And there's something great about a synergy of a bunch of dudes who like each other, who are cool with each other, and who are, like, you know, watching each other's back and coming up in the game together and supportive. Yeah. And it's a real testament after 20 years that you guys have been friends this long, have been loyal to each other this long.
Yeah, man.
And even after 20 years, you know, I just saw you know, David Letterman has that Netflix special, and he had Ellen on there.
Okay.
And she was, and her career kind of suffered after she came out the closet.
Mm-hmm.
She had a TV show. She couldn't get a job. Like, no one was trying to book her.
Yeah.
And she landed her Ellen TV show when she was 45, and which is her most successful thing ever, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and it was at the, you know, it's, no one ever thinks they're going to be successful in their 40s.
Right. Yeah. Right.
But it's here, like, she is at 45, and she's
larger than ever.
Yeah, just larger than ever. And I feel like right now with you guys and what you guys are doing after 20 years, I think it's such an incredible, and it's a beautiful thing to see a group of friends work together, come together at a 20-year anniversary and be like, yo, there's something here. And then slowly build in the next 5 years this empire.
Thanks, man. I appreciate that. Yeah, you know, it means a lot. Yeah,
no,
yeah.
I understand, I really love operations. I love, like, you know, just how things work organically. when it's not forced, and you know,
right.
And with social media, there's a lot of like smoke and mirrors, you know.
Oh yeah, 100%.
For me, like when I see things like this, and I look at the pattern of business, you know, like I'm like, okay, you know, 2014, you know, record pool, clothing line, right. 2017, school,
right.
You know, radio show, like everything just starts a pattern,
right.
And you guys just start organizing, and even you telling me how you guys spent a year just building the school together,
yeah, right.
Which is crazy,
yeah.
With no money coming in,
yeah.
And just working on the shit for yeah. a year, which is not easy either.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's a lot of doubts and
a lot of frustrating moments for sure.
Exactly. Sometimes you want to give up,
right. Like, and I think it's important that all y'all motherfuckers really listen and just kind of like understand that in 20 years, you guys can still build something incredible and keep the legacy going to yeah. what you guys, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think that's really great.
Thank you. Yeah, we're pretty fortunate. Been pretty fortunate to kind of be where mm-hmm. we are today and have the ventures that we do with the record pool, Beat Junkies TV, the DJ school, and for them to most importantly be well received, you know,
yeah.
across the board in the DJ community. So yeah, we're super grateful for.
So after that, after you guys got together and you guys had a moment to soak it all in, what was the initial steps to really just start getting the ball rolling on like, look, there's a brand out here that's still strong, mm-hmm. and we got to capitalize on it, and we got to like market, we got to build something.
You're talking about after the anniversary?
Yeah.
So so funny story. So he's one of our guys. I don't know if you guys have ever met him, but he goes by DJ For Real. His name's Sunil.
I know Sunil.
Okay, yeah. So he was doing a party called Red Cup Sundays.
Downtown. Yeah. Icon.
So at Icon, exactly. Mm-hmm. So he would bring us all out, you know, all the junkies, you know, we'd rotate whatever. And so every time I would go to DJ, so this is right after the anniversary, maybe 2013-ish,
yeah.
like 2012 mm-hmm. maybe, like I think right around
the
anniversary.
2013.
So he would bring me out to do the club Friday, Saturday night, and then we started doing Red Cup. He would bring me out to DJ, and so every time I would come through, he'd be like, "Mello, he's like, we gotta sit down and talk about doing a record pool."
Mm-hmm.
It was really his idea, and he'll tell you the story. I was always against it. I was like, "Nah, man, record pool, like, I don't know, man. Like, I don't really know too much about it, like, other than being a user, because I was, you know, I was always using like DMS, and I think DJ City they set me up with an account, and
yeah.
I was still more focused on DJing. I just wanted to DJ and do clubs.
By the
and
way,
stuff.
DJ City is one of the best record pools out there.
Number one.
Did I hear right? Did you say DJ City is the number one record pool?
It's also one of the best waters out there in Camp.
Don Julio.
Shameless plug. Sure. No, shout out to DJ City, man.
Look, there's definitely different brands of water out there, and DJ City is definitely the Fiji of water, and it's you know, it's out there.
For the Road Podcast, this is our water.
So planted the seed for the record pool.
Right, and I just shut them down. I probably shut them down like a dozen times, and finally, like, I was like, all right, man, I'll get the fellas together. So we sat down at Icon. We had a meeting and stuff, and just so that we started just kind of brainstorming on how to mm-hmm. build a record pool. And I said, all right, well, if we're going to build one, we got to build one that's true to kind of our brand. You know what I'm saying? Like, we can't just go out there and just be, okay, we got a record pool of all the hits. Like, people are just, well, we'll get fucking dissed for that shit. You know what I mean? Like, we can integrate the hits, but we got to, like, make it, like, our shit. Like, you know, shit that we play, like, the records that we've collected. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and that took, fuck, man. Yeah, that was a good year and a half
mm-hmm.
to build that out.
It seems like there was a 2-year gap where you launched it because
launched in 2014.
Yeah, because the anniversary mm-hmm. was 2012.
2012.
Yeah, it was like 2 years.
So yeah, it was about, I was almost, that makes total sense. It was about a year and a half, I remember.
I really like how you guys take your time to build something.
Yeah, I mean, trust me, if it was up to me, like, I would get it done faster.
Yeah.
But like stuff like that, big projects like that, like they take time, you know, and you want to put thought into it. And there's little things and hiccups that happen along the way. And then, when you're setting up business entities, like you're dealing with paperwork and mm-hmm. that type of stuff. So you have to have, you know, all your T's crossed, your I's dotted. Stuff like that takes time. But that took about a year and a half to build out program.
You launched the record pool
mm-hmm.
and then that slowly builds. And then the next stage, what kind of initiated the next stage?
So that was like, okay, so we have the record pool, obviously we're all still very active as live DJs, like we can always go out and play live and book and mm-hmm. travel and tour and stuff, again, this goes back to what I was telling you guys earlier. D Styles is just like, okay, well, let's figure out what's the next thing we can do, you know what I mean, and attach that makes sense for our brand, for the Beat Junkies, and that was the DJ school. Then fast forward, we opened that in mm-hmm. April of 2017. We got the keys for the building in June of 2016. So a little less than a year to build out, like 10 months.
I love how organic everything plays out. And then obviously you have the school, and then you launch Beat Junkies TV.
Because now we have a space, you know, right. We can, it's our spot, so we can pretty much do whatever we want. So it's just like, okay, let's take advantage of, you know what I mean? We have all this equipment, like we're teaching lessons, so let's start another business. So we launched Beat Junkies TV in July of last year. So that's coming up on a year old. Yeah, and that's going really well. But with the subscription stuff, you know, it's a funny business, because you see people come and go. You know what I'm saying? Like, people will subscribe, and we have subscribers that have been with us since day one on the record pool. Right. You know what I'm saying? They pay their $35 or their whatever X amount of dollars per year. And then, like, you know, we'll get emails from DJs that'll, you know, more like on the courtesy tip, like, oh man, like, you know, Christmas is coming up. I'm trying to, or I'm saving up for this or that. Like, I don't want to lose my subscription, but I'm going to come back. And sometimes they, you know, we'll get that email, hey, I'm back. You know what I mean? And, okay, cool. And sometimes they don't. You know what I'm saying? Some cats, they'll sign up for like a month and they just want to just, like, kind of just go through the site and just get as much music as they can, and hey, that's cool, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, and the same thing with Beat Junkies TV. Some people will sign up for a month, and some people will sign up just out of curiosity to check it out. We have other content on there too, just that's available for people that are not DJs but are maybe an enthusiast. But it's been good to us, man. It's really cool. And the cool thing about, as you guys I'm sure you know, like running an online business, like compared, and this is another hard lesson that we learned, like the school, the actual Beat Junkie Institute of Sound in Glendale, like that's our first brick and mortar operation. That shit is no fucking joke, man. It's like you're dealing with overhead, you're dealing with rent, you're dealing with, you know, utilities, you know, wear and tear, equipment, sales tax, all that, man. So it's just like, you know, it's very expensive.
Cali is bad too, because you guys have the most like entrepreneurial, like for an entrepreneur, business owner, you have the most, you got all types of taxes.
Yeah, not to get too into it, but there's three different tiers of taxes in the state of California. So there's like a Northern California tax, there's an LA County tax, and then there's an Orange County, and they're different tax rates. But they're all sick. They're all like in the double digits, you know, retarded, you know.
Just quick question, good or bad, did you see any changes when you guys started really taking it serious as a business? Because I mean, you guys have always been homies,
you know, internally, you mean within our infrastructure. We've had to definitely have some hard conversations with each other. We haven't always agreed. Sometimes we've just had to agree to disagree, kind of thing. And it does get stressful when you're dealing with costs, you know, operation costs and stuff like that, especially with the school. You know, it was it was stressful for the first year, because again, we weren't quite sure how to do it, you know, and we had never done it before. We were definitely giving it our best shot, you know what I'm saying, trying to program it correctly and do whatever we could to attract students and attract interest. But you know, with us having, I don't know, let's say in the beginning for the first year, maybe we only had 30 regulars, you know what I'm saying? We still have to keep the lights on, we still have bills to pay. We're definitely trying to pay ourselves as instructors, as employees, you know what I mean? We have a staff that we have to take care of, that works very hard for us. And it's not, to answer your question, it's definitely not easy. There's definitely, I'd have to say, like, that's probably being in business together probably was the first time in all of our years that we really, I wouldn't say we got at each other's throats, but we definitely like had some differences of opinion and just had some things we had to iron out, you know, as friends and now as business partners. So it definitely changes the dynamic a little bit, but ultimately for the better, you know what I mean? Ultimately for the positive, because it's at the end of the day, it's our shit. We own it, you know what I'm saying? And we can program it, we can move it, we can keep it where we want. I mean, it's ours to do with whatever we choose, you know? So ultimately, like, it's a good thing, you know?
Are you guys gonna try to open up another one?
We've actually had a couple of people approach us. We were offered to, I don't really want to say who with, but somebody very notable recently offered us to partner up with him in New York. And nice. And somebody else, we've had some interest from Japan, but nice. We're not quite there yet. I'm thinking, you know, talking with the fellas, like, let's just really just hone in and just really get this LA location up and running, focus on just making this as great as possible. And then maybe like within like 2 to 3 years, maybe we can start considering opening up an extension, you know, another Beat Junkie Institute Sound.
As a business owner, almost like you guys, I would actually, hold off on expanding.
Yeah, for sure.
I think expansion nowadays, I think me, myself, and my generation, we grew up in the era where franchising and expanding was like a part of success in business.
Right.
And I think that's kind of, that's in this day and age, I think it's a little bit of a lie. I think you're better off being more exclusive and staying where you are.
Right, boutique. Yep, exactly. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not even boutique, but just being like Harvard is Harvard. There is no like Harvard Cali.
Right.
Everyone just has to go to Harvard.
Yeah.
They got to
move.
That's
a good point.
Yep. You know, so for me, I always feel like just be the best one. As soon as you open two, you've got to have four eyes now.
Yeah, yeah.
And if you have two set of eyes, obviously, if there's another second set of eyes that you can't trust or doesn't execute things at the standards that you hold,
I agree 100% with everything you're saying.
Then you're better off not opening a second one, because what's going to happen is you're going to be spreading yourself thin over two locations.
Yeah, and you can't be there all the time. And you know what I'm saying?
Especially when it's bi-coastal, you're going to go crazy. Sure.
Yeah,
you're almost better off expanding the website.
Right, exactly. And that's why we launched the website, Beat Junkies TV.
Yeah, definitely.
So,
yeah.
So, yeah. I personally am not really like looking to, you know, open up a second or even possibly a third location. It sounds great, like in theory.
On paper, it sounds great.
Trust me, I thought about it. All the things you just mentioned, just like those are my reasons like not to do it.
It always sounds great on
paper.
There's
like a long list of cons like that. Like there's obviously some pros in there too, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, it's just, that's a lot of pressure. That's a lot of weight.
Because honestly, like if I had a business and if it was really lucrative and I was like, look, I'm going to take either a piece of this, of the gross profits, and put it into another business and possibly hemorrhage money for the next 6 months to build that location up and have it run. It's kind of like, you can only really do that with restaurants, because restaurants is built on consistency.
Right.
You know, it's like making one product really good over and over and over again.
Right.
If you have a limited menu, like a burger or an In-N-Out burger, you know, it's fairly simple once the system is set.
Yeah.
With a school.
Absolutely.
You know, with anything dealing with customer service that like tightly, and having a curriculum and having people be the driving force of something and splitting that, it's a very different thing, I think. Yeah.
And empowering and trusting people to teach like our method, our style of teaching. I mean, even me, like, took me like, I'm still learning, mind you, but it took me a year to really get comfortable. And like I said, just think about trying to, how would you guys explain like mixing to someone? Like, how would you sit there and articulate the concept of mixing?
Right.
I'll tell you a story. I remember out here at, when I was at Body English, there was this guy, he played for Manchester United. He was a soccer, professional soccer player. And so during the off season, he had property out here, I think in Summerlin. And so he would come and chill in Vegas, whatever, for a couple months. And he used to always come to Body English. His name was Matt. Super cool dude. Come in the booth and kick it. And, you know, he was always like, you know, making comments about like DJing and what I was doing and, you know, stuff like that. And so he's like, one night he asked me like, would you come by and teach me? Can you teach me?
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, yeah, sure, man. Like, whatever. You know what I mean? Cool cat. So we exchange info. He gives me his address. I go to his crib in Summerlin, right? I think he gives me like $100 or whatever. No big. I wasn't, you know, I was just trying to help him. So he's like, he's got a turntable. He has a Technics 1200. He has a mixer. And so I bring some records. And so I put on, I forget which 12-inch it was, the LL Cool J 12-inch. And I start trying to teach him how to scratch, like the head note, the burn. Like, I think it was, I'm bad, right? Burn. I was like, okay, so like, you know, your visual marker's here. I was like, take your hand, put it here. And it was at that moment, I was like, damn, like, this is just not gonna work. Like, how do I explain this to dude? You know what I'm saying? Like, and now it's just like, you know, when we're actually teaching, we have a school, like we had to sit down and thoughtfully like iron out these notes. Thank God we have Mr. Chalk, because, you know, he's a veteran when it comes to teaching, but like, it's definitely not an easy thing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And then as a teacher, you know, they're looking to you as the instructor. So you gotta be fucking on point. You can't miss a fucking beat, man. You can't miss a scratch. You can't miss a blend. You can't hit the wrong button on Serato. Like, you can't make any mistakes. There's no room for error. You know what I mean? So it's cool, man. It's gotten us all really close to DJing again, and in a good way that I think we probably haven't been for probably since the anniversary. You know what I'm saying? Just being on in front of the turntables all the time, thinking about music, thinking about the art, the craft all the time, and then creating these lessons and lesson plans. It's fun. It's actually really fun, and it's really it's very fulfilling. Like I said, when you see whether it's a child or like, you know, a young adult. Oh man, I get it. Like, it clicks.
Mm-hmm.
Just like, oh, it's so dope, man. It's just like, it's very rewarding. It's cool, man. I really enjoy it. We all enjoy it. But
do you feel like if you guys have tried to do this 5 years earlier, it wouldn't have worked?
Nah, I don't think it would have worked.
I don't think it would have worked.
Yeah.
The surprising thing is that you guys are pushing a school that is really bringing back the essence of DJing from, you know, from the and originating from hip hop. You know, what would you call it? Like from hip hop roots,
right?
But it's funny that EDM really brought the DJ to the forefront,
commercialized it a lot,
to the point where people wanted to become a DJ.
For
sure. So it's like if we didn't have EDM, you wouldn't really have this large market of people who want to be DJs,
right? Interested
at the superstardom of it all. Maybe some of the music. Oh, I love this music. This is so cool looking, or I want to be a part of this.
Yep.
And then they come to your school and then they really learn the essence of what it is. And how many times, I want to kind of ask you two questions. How many times have you gotten someone who came in thinking DJing was one thing and then figured out later that it was another and had them totally change and seen this person's kind of their whole perception of what DJing was about totally changed for the better.
For the better. Okay.
Yeah, I would not think for the worse after going to your school, right? And then also seeing the next generation, where do you think they're headed and where that's going and how that's going to mix up because of what the club scene is like and, you know, obviously what this new generation is kind of not obsessed with, but I would say there a lot of the younger DJs are into the routines. I was recently talking to a younger DJ who was doing like their first gig and was asking me about some pointers. And I think in their head they thought DJing a night in a club was a bunch of routines, like an Instagram routine, like one after another. And I was like, no, it's more about
programming, selection.
Yeah, and I didn't really know how to really explain it to them. I was just kind of like, you kind of got to play a song and read how the crowd responds. And then keep going. And then, you know, if you're hitting different genres, you know, like kind of spread out like a branch.
Yeah. You got to tell a story, take them on a journey, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think for the younger generation, how can you tell that story through an Instagram 1 minute video? You can't.
Yeah. No, for sure.
You know what I mean?
That's something that's
so the only thing they know is these routines. They're just like, oh, I got to have like 20 routines to do a whole night. It's like, you know, I think that this kid was like stressing out. Like I gotta do 2 hours. I've got like, you know, like 15 routines and I'm working on like six more.
Five short.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm just like, dude, you're gonna have like a fucking heart attack. Like just
Imagine that
shit.
Like, every routine's 3 minutes.
It's like doing a whole like Red Bull freestyle competition by yourself. It's like you're doing the whole Red Bull freestyle competition by yourself for like an hour.
No, for sure. We definitely like I said, you know, the way our method of teaching, it's, you know, half lecture, half exercise.
Yeah.
So, you know, part of the lecture, part of the things that we dialogue with the students about are, you know, there's many layers to DJing, right? Mm-hmm. To the craft, you know what I'm saying? And we're going to present it to you our style. Like, and Beat Junkie style is basically, it's that. It's mixing, party rocking, programming, music selection, and then it's scratching. You know what I'm saying? If you want to, like, dive more into, like, you know, more intricate, advanced techniques. But whatever you're going to do, you know, you do all these things and you do them well, okay? And so, like, definitely there's a skill in programming a nightclub. There's a skill in playing a 2-4-6 hour set at a Vegas mega club, right? There's a skill in that, you know what I'm saying? And there's definitely, we're very adamant about encouraging students to practice, because whether you're a DJ, any fine art, you play guitar, you play piano, you're an athlete, like you're only going to improve, you're only going to elevate your skill set, master it potentially by practicing. Right. It's not just going to happen. Yeah, there's like cats that, like, you know, you hear about these naturals, you know, they're just gifted. And then there are some out there like that, you know, but for the most part, I'd say like 95, maybe even 97, 98% of people have to work to be great at something. You have to fucking work at that shit, man. So, I mean, you can't just come to school, come to class. Yeah, we'll give you like, you know, we're going to give you some bars for an hour a week, 2 hours a week, you know what I'm saying? But like, you have to, like, you know, in your downtime, come to student practice hours, come through and practice. If you have equipment at the house, practice. That's the only way you're going to get better.
What's been one of the main obstacles that you've been noticing with kind of the younger DJs coming in? A more instant gratification? They wanted to come quicker a little bit more?
We explain to them, like, it's not going to happen overnight. Some of them, they get frustrated because they expect to learn it, like a new, whether it's like a simple scratch, a release, they expect to, like, come to class for an hour and, like, learn it right away. But it's, you know, if you're just learning, mm-hmm. like, yo, you have to learn how to grip the fader. You have to get used to, like, where to properly place your hand. You have to read the visual marker. You're using your headphones. It's like, it requires mechanics. So it's just like, and we explain, like, don't get frustrated. You know what I'm saying? Don't, like, Chalk tells them, don't let frustration take you out the game. You know what I'm saying? Because this doesn't come overnight for all of us.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And in fact, like, you know, things that we're teaching them, they're learning in a year's time. Shit, man. Like, mixing probably took me, like, 2, maybe 3 years to, like, understand how to properly beat match, get that nice tight eight bar. Yeah. Seriously, man. Seriously. Like, it's to crazy. Do that shit live, like, in front of a live audience. Like, yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I was shoes in the dryer for a number of years, you know what I'm saying, when I was starting out, like, in the 80s and just learning. But, yeah, so we try and encourage them, like, you know, encourage them to practice. Mm-hmm. And so I think that kind of, like, you know, calms them down. Okay, cool. Like, it's not just me. Another big thing is, so when we do this vinyl final I was telling you guys about, right, so this assignment, so they have to come up and perform that on the stage.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Right, in front of us, right, and we grade them. We give them progress reports. They get report cards. And in front of their classmates, right? And every single one of them never fails. Every single one of them, they get up there and they're trembling, man. Like, they're nervous. Like, they're on a stage. Like, they're used to working at a workstation with a single monitor mm-hmm. in front of them. They have their own kind of physical space. They're isolated. Like, they yeah. know they feel like, you know, they're in their own little cubicle, if you will. But you get up on the stage and you got, like, you know, 15, 16 sets of eyes and ears on you, and now you're on a loud sound system. You know, we got the bass cabinets, we got the QSE joints.
Every mistake.
Oh, yeah, everything. And it feels different, you know what I'm saying? Because you're playing on a loud system. Like, we bump in there. Like, we go hard, you know? And so they all say the same thing, like, oh my God, I'm so nervous. I get so nervous, you know what I mean? And we tell them, yo, like, that never goes away. Like, I've been doing this shit fucking almost 30 years. Like, I'm not gonna front. Like, I step into a club or a gig, or especially a showcase, even a small bar where there's like 50, 60 people, and I know everyone's watching and listening. Yeah, like, for the first, like, 2 or 3 records, like, it takes me a few minutes to get settled in, get comfortable, yeah. let the nerves calm down a little bit. Maybe I need a cocktail or whatever to kind of, like, take the edge off a little bit. But that's some real shit. Like, don't let that fucking discourage you.
It'll never go away.
You know
what I'm
saying? It never goes away. I don't know. How's it for y'all? Or y'all just, like, been doing it so long? Like, you go to do a set. Like, you guys have
still feel
nerves? Like, yeah.
But right. I make sure I don't look nervous.
Right. Exactly.
Sweating. When
but inside, I'm dying inside. You know what I mean?
So, like, sometimes when I do a new venue that I've never done before, I get a little bit nervous.
Yeah, for sure. But, like, you know, you settle in, right? Eventually, get the first, like, whatever, 10 like minutes,
that
5 minutes.
Anxious blood going, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like the tip off before the game.
But it's also the fact that even if it's not going well the first 3 or 4, 5 records or the first 10 minutes of you going on, you still got to look confident.
Mm-hmm. And not panic.
Yeah.
And you got to make sure you look like, fuck this, like, yep. I know what I'm
exactly.
doing.
Yeah, we tell them that too. Like, don't do that. Don't shake. Don't be up there shaking your head. Like, you know, if you make a mistake or something happens, a record skips, whatever, take your time. Close a fader. Take your needle back up. There's no hurry.
Dude, yeah. Cue up. I got to tell you this. Like, even if you're bombing, and, like, don't look like you're bombing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I've seen some DJs, and I'm just
in the
like,
club,
dude.
You mean?
Yeah.
Seen DJs in the club.
Yeah, I'll see them, and I'm like looking at them, and they're not doing bad, but they're
body language suggests that
they look like they think they're doing bad,
right? And they're
and then it just kind of fucks with the crowd because the crowd is looking at them like,
yeah,
are you not?
They're tearing, shit, like,
which is kind of like you can just tell their face like,
nervous.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
When I fuck up and, like, the record skips or something, I look at the fucking equipment like they did something wrong.
Yeah. That's a good thing to do. I used to, you know, when I used
like,
to
what the fuck?
Sound man, that's a great thing to do.
And it's like
I used to miss vinyl because when I did like a fucked up mix or when things weren't going right and I went the wrong direction, you could like turn around and like pretend you're looking for records and be like, oh my God, I suck. I fucking suck. And you're like, I remember I was having an off night, and this was like probably in the early 2000s when I was on vinyl.
Okay.
And I was turning around, and I was going through my records. I'm like, you fucking suck.
Go home.
And one of my boys like walked up, and I was like talking to myself. I'm like, you fucking suck. And he was just looking at me like, are you talking to yourself?
Now, but we all have those moments, though, right? Like, that's real shit. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? We all have bad nights. We all have an off blend, or we all like hit the wrong button in Serato, like load the shit to the wrong side. Like, it happens to everybody. We're not bots. We're humans. You know what I mean? Like, no one's perfect. You know what I mean? As much as you practice, as solid as you can be, like, we're going to make mistakes. It's going to happen. And just some people are harder on themselves than others. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But
I mean, one of the greatest things would be K. Capri would fuck up and he'd get on the mic. He'd be like, pardon me, y'all.
Yeah.
He'd be like, yo, pardon that.
Let me bring this shit back.
I'm like, wait, fuck that. I'm gonna bring this shit back. Let's do this shit the right way.
You're
better off like
owning it.
Owning it up, but having that confidence, like, yeah, I fucked up. Yeah. Like, so what? Like, I'm gonna keep this shit going. Like, even if you're not doing well or whatever, just like
put on a show.
Yeah,
I'm gonna keep blaming the equipment every time.
What are you gonna do? Just like throw the turntable?
Like, what the fuck, mixer? Why did you just like do that?
You know what that is? Like, you know, the examples you're citing, like with the kids, like making the faces and stuff. Like, that's just inexperience, yo. Like, that's just straight inexperience. You know what I mean? Like, you spend enough time, like, you know, DJing or like whatever. If you're a musician playing whatever, and you know, get experience, like, you know not to do that. You know not to, like, you know, start crying or whatever. Like, I don't know, man.
So this the vinyl final.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys get so there hasn't been one that was just like, yo, they're cool as a cucumber and they're confident they do this shit. Pretty much all of them kind of go through some type of.
I would be fucking nervous even now.
How many people are watching this, by the way? Like watching the whole graduating class or something?
The graduation's different. So the vinyl final happens at our school.
Yeah, the vinyl final. How many people are watching the vinyl final?
12 plus two instructors. I'd say probably 16, 18, something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, so very, very intimate, you know, super 20 small.
20 people is not intimate for a 10-year-old.
Yeah. No, not the kids. This is for the adults.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, you don't put the kids through this?
No.
I thought you were teaching them young.
Not the final. Actually, you know what? Maybe they do, because I don't personally teach the kids class anymore. So I'd have to cross-check that with Babu and Shock. There might be a vinyl. I know they put the kids do get up on stage and perform.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? But mm-hmm. I don't think there's an actual final where they're graded, but I could be wrong.
How did you grade? Like, but through letters or numbers?
So just as 1 to 5 scale. And just different, we have different categories and stuff, and they get progress reports, you print them out, you know what I mean? It's just like a regular school.
Is it difficult putting ones?
I've never had to put a one.
Damn.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even if he wanted to, even if it was so bad that you was just like, I can't do the one. You give him like a two.
One has probably got to be more attitude based, right?
No, because they're all excited to do it. You know, they're all passionate about it. They're there obviously because they want to be there.
You're not like Leo's an asshole, but he's good. But I'm gonna give him two.
No, but we've had some. I had one student last year that she was struggling. Like she was struggling just her rhythm. Like just you know. Just took her longer to develop, and so we had to hold her back. We had to have her repeat a couple levels before she could graduate, just because like she just learned at a much slower pace.
Mm-hmm.
But we're always mindful, trying to like just you know speak to them constructively. You're not trying to like you know like discourage
smack
people. Like,
yo,
this ain't for you, man. You fucking suck. Like, nah, man. You know what I'm saying? Like, we all sucked when we first started. You know what I mean? So. But yeah, but that doesn't happen very often. I think there's been two students like that, both adults, that we've had to have them repeat just because we want them to get it down. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? And at the end of the day, ultimately for us, like, you know, if and when some of our students go out and start DJing and, you know, I went to the Beat Junkie Institute of Sound, like they're a reflection of us.
Yeah, you know can't what I'm have saying? Them, so, like, not knowing
yeah, we can't have them up there bricking and, you know
hey,
what I'm saying?
Hey,
like,
I'm Beat Junkies.
Yeah. You know?
Fucking up your name.
Like, yo, man, that school sucks, bro. You heard it?
They're a representation.
Last 3 motherfuckers
those
I heard.
Students are horrible. They cleared the room out.
For graduation, do you guys give out like something cool like the ring or what?
So we give out a ring. So we approach it like
we gotta go guys, I want a ring.
like a dojo, like a martial arts dojo. You know how there's like a purple belt, blue belt, white belt. So mm-hmm. we give them like we have different levels. So if they graduate a program they get a white ring. So like a white belt. It's kind of like mm-hmm. we're, you know, like kind of honoring them with that. And then they get a plaque. Graduation plaque, and we do the actual graduations. We've been doing them at this place called the Brew Yard. It's a brewery, small spot, but they can invite their friends and family. It's mm-hmm. open to the public. Obviously, people that are just hanging out, having wings and beer, like they can, you know, they're spectators. But yeah, those are a big deal because the graduation, they perform a 15-minute set in front of. It's like a gig. So like the last graduation was that was in March, and there was probably a good 150.
Wow.
Between 150 and 200 people there. So they had an actual audience. But it's real dope, man. Like, they get up there, we introduce them. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's like a gig. Yeah, yeah. Like, we yell next up. Like, this.
Another graduation coming up soon, right?
We have the next one. Our next graduation class is August. August.
That's great. Mm-hmm.
Yep. And the class that I'm teaching with Rhett, they just finished level 3, so they have another seven or eight months to go, and then we'll host graduation for them.
Nice.
So yeah, it's cool, man. It's really cool. Yeah, if you guys are ever in LA, please fall through.
I'm gonna come this next week.
And we offer private lessons too. We've all done a number of private lessons, and it's just for people that, for the most part, they're experienced. And they want to learn a certain technique from me, or they want to learn a scratch from Babu, or they want to work with Chalk and talk to him about radio. And the interest range, like I had this one guy come in early on after we first opened, and he just wanted to talk about live DJing. He wanted to talk about song selection, programming, spending at clubs, you know what I mean? Yeah. He wanted to know what my approach was for that, you know what I'm saying? So I walked him through and opened up my Serato crates and just kind of showed him my process with that. And then we ran through a couple of mixes. He showed me a couple things. I was like, show me a couple things that you're doing, you know? And then so he would show me like a mix or two, something that was always part of his set. And I'd be like, okay, well, let's try it this way. Like, try doing this, you know what I mean? So stuff like that. And then I have people that come in and just want to learn. I saw you do this Biggie juggle on IG. Like, can you teach me that one move that you did?
Interesting.
That one technique. And then I have people that come in and just want to learn a scratch. They want to like practice scratching with me for an hour, you know. So
I just want to scratch for an hour, Melo-D.
Yeah.
Pause.
Hey, yo.
That's awesome. Hey, yo.
So does the school take up a majority of your time?
I'm there 2 days a week. But in the beginning, we were all there. We're open 6 days a week. But in the beginning, we were all there 5-6 days a week.
Wow, yeah.
And then eventually we figured out, like, damn, we got to kind of find some kind of schedule here. Chalk and Babu were there full time. So they're there 4 days a week. Myself and Rhett Maddock are there 2 days a week. J-Rock comes through for things like a master class or for doing like a special event. Every once in a while when Shortcut's in town, he'll come through and, you know, do something with us. We do Q&As, so we've had Crazes come through, like a panel. You know what I mean? We'll put them on stage, and they bring people out. So we'll get like 200 people in our spot, and they'll come to hear, you know, Craze talk about, you know, his history with DJing. And we had Cuber come through. Z-Trip came in, did something. Most recently, we had Jazzy Jeff. He was our guest there, and that was packed. That was super dope. We do just different kind of events and stuff like that. So, I'm there twice a week.
But you're still gigging, because I see you're coming out like for Best Friend and On the Record out here that just opened at the Park MGM.
Yep.
And are you guys tight with Roy Choi?
Yeah, that's the homie. Yeah. So he had a spot in LA in Koreatown, in K-Town. It was the Lion Hotel, but he had a restaurant called Pot. And so, shout out to Roy. He's an Angelino through and through. So, you know, he's around our age, and he came up on the same musical interest that we all did. He's a, you know, heavy indie hip hop fan and knows what's up with the crew. And so when he opened up that restaurant, he wanted to bring in, he's like, I want to have you guys come DJ. You know what I'm saying? So we started, that was in 2014, 2015. So it's real chill, just like a lobby bar, a hotel lobby bar. Mm-hmm. But he wanted like our flavor, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, so we would do that, I think, once a week or once a month, something like that. Maybe it was a monthly. So we did that for maybe 3 years. And then, we knew that he was going to be opening up a spot out here. So he's like, man, I got something coming for y'all.
Yeah, you guys did the grand opening, right?
We did. Yeah. For New Year's Eve weekend.
I thought it was dope because it was like really bringing like the essence of L.A. Vegas. You know what I mean?
For sure,
having you guys be cool, and then having the Beat Junkies do like the grand opening.
Word.
I was feeling the vibes on that shit. I was liking it a lot. Yeah.
Word. Thank you. Yeah, that was fun. It was really cool about that, spending in the restaurant. Because obviously that's the format, you know, it's Roy, so he wants us to do our shit, you know what I'm saying? And so we played everything. We played some classic hip hop, you know, but all the stuff that you see in the record pool, 80s funk, R&B, disco, breaks, rock and doubles, our style. But man, there was so many people that came up to the booth just like giving us pound, like just for the music selection.
Yeah.
We're not up there like doing battle routines or nothing. We're just like, you know, we're vibing, you know what I'm saying?
Having,
like
having some fun.
Playing tunes. Exactly. And people that just really appreciated it. It was just like, wow, this is fucking perfect timing right here. Like this is the kind of gigs that we want and should be doing. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to Roy and everybody at Best Friend.
And then you guys are on the menu.
Yeah.
A picture of you guys on the menu.
There is, yeah. They threw us in the menu. Yeah, it's an old picture. That's an old
Jimmy said y'all went to high school together.
I heard you guys went to high school together.
With
Roy.
No.
Somebody told me that.
I know. I personally did.
He made that shit up.
We didn't throw me under the bus, never.
No.
Jimmy, I heard that somewhere.
No, because we all.
Yeah, no. I was gonna confirm that or deny that.
I can see, I can see that shit just spewing out of Jamie's mouth.
Yeah, I was like, really? Oh shit, I didn't know.
Yeah, yeah, that's what somebody told me.
They went to school. They went to school with Beat Junkies.
He said they have the picture.
Nah, we're all LA heads. We're all Southern California kids.
Well, so. I like how that Roy Choi is like a, you know, he's become like a staple, a representative of LA, and then you know, you guys, you know, after 25 years, how do you guys feel about, you know, your presence in Cali and LA? Because I feel like you guys are a staple. I feel like, and I think your school will hopefully become a bigger staple dare I say, a landmark of LA. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
if you guys
keep
going, you know?
It's kind of working towards that. We've kind of become, I think I was saying this before we started recording, we've kind of become like this, the hub for just the DJ community in LA.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, we get people that literally fly in from Japan, from Europe, from Australia. They come straight from LAX to the school. Like, they literally walk in with a suitcase because we're like, our spot is like some bucket list shit. You know what I mean? And they come and they want to scratch with us, or they want to just take pictures, and it's really dope, man. But to answer your question, yeah, I mean, LA's that's home base for us. That's our home turf. We're all, you know, born and raised out there, and we're always going to represent that LA shit. You know what I'm saying? Through and through. After being in the game this long as the Beat Junkies, we always say our brand is bigger than all of us individually.
Yeah.
You know, and so after being around this long, we could step out to a do-over, you know, a couple times a summer. We can throw our own night, something like an anniversary or a special one-off, or, you know, we can go do something really low-key at this like cool posh little bar over here, and like people will come through and, you know what I'm saying, come out and support. Because when we do DJ now, because we have the record pool, because we have the school, because we have Beat Junkies TV, we're kind of more selective about the nights that we do.
Right.
So, you know, unfortunately, we can
because
afford to be that
you
way.
Because you want the nights to be on brand with right. what exactly. what you're doing.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, you know, we don't DJ as often as we used to, but that's kind of by choice, by design.
Mm-hmm.
At home, we try and just keep a low pro. And if we do something, we try and make it special, you know what I'm saying? Or make it unique from the last gig that we did or the next time you're going to see us.
Jamie kind of called you guys the...
the Wu-Tang of DJing.
Yeah.
Interesting.
I didn't know about that.
And I kind of agree with him. Mm. You know, I think 25 years is something to be very proud of.
The logo's, like, you could spot it anywhere.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
And it's known.
Wu-Tang, and it's
like, you guys know, you guys are kind of spread out. Individually, you guys are great. And then together, you guys are still great.
Mm, thanks,
so that's
man.
Why I'm like, yeah, it's kind of like, you haven't seen unity on DJing. Like, I mean, you guys damn near have more members, but... It's like, I don't know, it feels like that. It feels like the Wu-Tang of DJing.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that, because that's really like, that's really what it is. I mean, we're family, we're crew, you know what I'm saying? We're brothers. We've been down with each other half a lifetime, you know what I mean?
But I think it's also the
I'm
fact
glad
that
it translates that way, you know?
I think it's also for the fact that the Wu-Tang brand has, you know, gone beyond just music. It's, you know, it's like
where
you'll rock the. But I mean, it's an expansion. It's like a. It's like yeah. you know. It's yeah, it's no, gone beyond. It's like a movement. So I think
it
would
be on the group.
Yeah.
And then like when I was like DJing and stuff like that, when I began DJing, like we all the little crew that I hang out with, we all kind of had our favorite member of the Beat Junkies.
Hey,
my boy Triumph, like he was a big fan of you. And then I was I was a big fan of Mr. Chalk, no disrespect to you.
Yeah.
But it was just like one of those things where
I was
like
a fan of Mr. Chalk.
Yo, Mr. Chalk is
so
dope.
They're kind of like the Spice Girls too as well.
It's funny because we do get people all the junkies will get messages or comments from time to time, you're my favorite junkie, or you know what I mean, stuff like that. Or people, you know, they'll come up to us at like the anniversary and they'll buy a t-shirt and we're signing the shirt, and you know, they take a picture and like, oh, my favorite junkie.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean, so it's cool, man. It's just like, it's funny, like it's an analogy I can make for you guys. So like, okay, so when I was working out here, like in the nightclub, it's always nice. I mean, obviously, like, you know, being a working DJ, like, you know, part of it is getting paid, right?
Yeah,
you know
of course.
What I'm saying? But ultimately for me, like, and I don't know how you guys feel about this, because I know we've all had moments like this where it's like, let's say you're playing a club set and you know, out here in Vegas, you're playing whatever, Hawkson or whatever, and you get somebody that just comes up to you and they're like, yo, you're fucking dope. You're like, you know what I mean? Like, versus like someone like, oh yeah, you're a great DJ, good job DJ. But someone like, you can tell like in the way they say it to you, they express it to you, like they really appreciate what you were doing as a DJ.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Whether it was like fucking putting together a nice little fucking power set or quick mixing or like finessing something with a scratch. Like, to me, that's the stuff that's invaluable. Right. Like, I'm going to remember that, and that's going to last with me way longer than that paycheck or whatever the money I got for the gig that night. I don't know if you guys, if you feel that way about that kind of stuff, but to me, like, some of my best nights just across the board, whether it's out here or somewhere else or overseas, have been those moments. Mm-hmm. Just like, damn, like, I really, like, fucking connected with this person. You know what I'm saying? They really, truly appreciate, like, what I did. Like, that's just, like I said, it's just, you can't put a price tag on some shit like that. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, yeah, that's just someone that truly appreciates, like, you know,
it's creatively, kind of, it's like, kind what of we why do. We all do this, right? To make that connection, you know, with the crowd. The, and if not, you know. And you guys have any other questions?
I'm good.
You good? No more Wu-Tang Spice Girl?
No. Fuck you.
You know what y'all need before we get out of here is, man, you guys need that when you do the intros, like, oh, you know, blah, 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 blah. Melo-D, you need the fucking Cairo. Because we're in Vegas, you got to get one of those machines.
Like, little confetti just spraying out motherfucker. Have a couple waitresses come out with a sparkler, drop the waters off.
The name tag, air horn, cards, like, spelling names.
Hey, yo, Melo, I'm really glad we had you here. I love just hearing the breakdown of L.A. and your guys' story and your guys' legacy of the 25 years. And you guys, you know, you guys approaching what, like 30? Probably 30 soon, right?
30, 22 years, probably. Yeah.
And yo, I mean, congratulations on all the success.
Thank you.
And I hope you guys, you know, continue it on and continue to push the craft and the brand and the movement forward. And yo, thanks so much for coming through, man.
Thanks for us. I appreciate y'all. It's my pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, man.
The GOAT,
sir.
The GOAT.
Thank you, guys. All right, word up.
And make sure you subscribe and comment on all our stuff on YouTube, youtube.com/RO.AD Podcast. Go ahead, drop comments. We're dropping videos every Friday. Hit the notification bell so you can get alerts when we upload.
Yes, and shout to the number one record pool.
Yeah, yeah.
Digital record pool.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we're out.
Peace. All right, peace.